This is the Discover Car Countdown to Green as we get ready to go racing.
The Bristol Motor Speedway in Tennessee has always been a magnet for racing excitement. What's the attraction? 43 fast cars on a high-banked short track under the lights on a Saturday night, surrounded by fans shoehorned into seats stacked to the sky. Oh yeah, and just three events remain in the race to the chase. It's the one night each year when it's okay to move the refrigerator into the TV room, because you don't want to miss a lap of the night race at Bristol. Bristol Motor Speedway.
Gather around.
The world's fastest half mile. Race fans love it. Some drivers don't.
No one can hang on to it.
A 500-lap traffic jam where patience wrestles with aggression.
Come up and run. Gordon underneath to the lead.
And tempers are put to the test.
You can see the frustrations running high down here.
Just three dates remain in the race to the chase. A four-time champion is back atop the standings. A rookie ranks as the 10th and final contender. And not far behind, the outsiders are racing again on. Sports presents the Sharpie 500, live from Bristol, Tennessee. Short track racing is a return to the rich and wild roots of motorsports. Hold one on a Saturday night, everybody wants to come. Hold it at Bristol, nobody wants to leave. Everybody, welcome to Victory Lane at Bristol. I'm Bill Weber. The TNT race family saved you a seat, and it's a good thing, because trying to get a ticket to this one is tougher than getting a ticket from Sheriff Andy Taylor. The top five drivers in the championship standings could mathematically clinch a spot in the 10-race chase to the championship tonight. The guys 6th through 10th in the standings could fall out of the chase, and the guys 11th through 15th could race their way in. All that could happen on a wild night under the lights at Bristol. We start at the front of the field and the top of the standings. That's one man with Matt Yocum.
And the man who has won from the pole 17 times in his career is Jeff Gordon. And many feel like the 24 car is the team to knock Kurt Busch's streak, make it come to an end. Though, do you race this race still as aggressively as in the past?
I think there's only one way to race at Bristol, and that's, you know, be aggressive. It's just a fast-paced racetrack. There's a lot of stuff going on. We've got, you know, great track position, a great place on pit road to pit. So we're just going to go out there and do it like we always do it. No different, you know, this time than any other one. That's just going to win.
The last time he won here, he started on the pole. Tonight he chases his sixth Bristol victory. To Marty Snyder.
Matt, August has been a month to forget for Jimmy Johnson. Three engine failures, and yesterday in practice wrecked his primary car, having to go to a backup car today. And are you done with the bad luck already?
I hope so. I mean, you know, two engine failures and a driver mistake that caused the third one, and then yesterday bottomed out in the racetrack, spun around and caught the inside wall. So I guess where we're starting dead last, you can't get any worse. So it's only going to go forward for us tonight. And the Lowe's car is in great shape. A lot of support from everyone at Hendrick Motorsports, Lowe's and all their employee owners. And we'll be back. You know, we've had a tough month, but that's what racing's about. There's lessons in all of it. And, you know, to be a champion, you've got to fight through all things and all odds. And we're ready for the battle.
This backup car has a pretty impressive resume, winning at Darlington and finishing second at California. Dave Burns.
Marty, Jamie McMurray helped his chase chances last week with a fourth place showing at Michigan. So tonight, going to be conservative out there? You going to look for more?
You know, just try to stay out of trouble. Typically at Bristol, I think when you get in trouble is when your car is not quite quick enough. But our car was, I told him last night after half hour, was the best car I've ever had here. And I think 11th's the worst we've ever finished. So our car is good, and just we're just going to try to keep our nose clean.
Jamie McMurray trying to make it to the chase. Ryan Newman, he wants to take that ride too.
Ride with me, ride with me, ride with me, ride with me.
And it's a pleasure to welcome Ryan Newman to the wagon. So how do you approach this half-mile bull ring?
You know, Jamie said keep your nose clean, but I think the bottom line is going to keep everything clean.
Yeah.
I mean, it's such
hard
an easy place to get caught up in somebody else's mess, let alone your own.
You guys have had some tough times since you went at Michigan, haven't you?
Yeah, we have, and you know, we know that we can bounce back, and our team is capable of getting the victory line just like we did at Michigan, so hopefully we can do that again.
Do you know how many points you are out of 10?
40-something.
44. Very good. Can you pick those up here tonight, Ryan, or do you just try and maintain?
We just do what we have to do, and that's finish the best possible finish that we can possibly get for our team and our all-tall Dodge. And, you know, if it's a top five, it's a top 10, whatever it is, we just focus on what we have to do. The points will take care of themselves.
What is it like in that car out there for 500 laps?
I'll tell you at the end, but I mean, it's a little bit of everything. Usually it's just, that's the best way to sum it up. It's a little bit of everything. You can be loose, you can be tight, you can get hit, you can be hitting. It's just a little bit of everything.
And pit road can be a challenge here, too.
On and off.
All right. Well, thanks for coming up. Best of luck tonight.
Thank you.
Ryan Newman looking for the win here in the Bristol Night Race. Here's a look at the top 20 in the championship standings heading into this one. This is the first time Jeff Gordon has led the standings since the season finale of 2001 at New Hampshire. Dale Earnhardt Jr. has just one top 20 finish in his last six races. From 6th to 10th, the margin is just 117 points. And after that, the outsiders banging on the bumper. Jamie McMurray in 15th, just 142 points out of 7. That's the first lap. Here's what's coming up on the Discover card. Countdown to green.
Kurt Busch is chasing his fourth straight win at Bristol. This native of noisy Nevada now makes his home in the quiet of North Carolina. We'll take a trip to the farm. Last week, one missing lug nut resulted in one disappointed team. But was it really missing? Dave with the next installment of Lug Nut Gate. Benny Parsons takes the wheel for a road trip with some of NASCAR's best drivers, and Wally Dallenbach demonstrates Bristol's trademark move, the bump and run. All that and Dale Earnhardt Jr. coming up on the Discover Card Countdown to Green.
With Rory Layden, the president of Sharpie, in the fourth year of the Sharpie 500 here at the Bristol Motor Speedway, why is this such an important investment for Sharpie, Rory?
Well, this gives Sharpie the opportunity to get our products into the hands of NASCAR fans who are incredibly loyal, and both use Sharpie markers on a regular basis.
And we have the new Sharpie Click, the new Sharpie marker. You've kind of unveiled this weekend. I've met Chad Campbell. You guys have a lot of things going on off the track, don't you?
Yes, we do. We unveiled the new Click Sharpie marker. All you need to do is click on the marker and not have to worry about a cap, holding on to a cap or losing a cap.
And your man, Kurt Busch, real quick, won three in a row here at Bristol. You confident of a fourth?
Well, I think we're better at making markers than we are at predictions, but we sure hope so. Kurt thinks he's got a fast car this weekend.
All right, Rory Layden, the president of Sharpie, the host of tonight's festivities here at the Bristol Motor Speedway.
Discover Card Countdown to Green, brought to you by Discover Card. It pays to discover. And by new Castrol GTX Startup Motor Oil.
Year-old Kurt Busch left his hometown of Las Vegas hoping to hit the jackpot in NASCAR. After he came up a big winner, he sent for his stuff, including his folks and his grandmother. He moved them across the country, then he moved them in right next door. On the weekends, Kurt Busch is outstanding in his field. And as Matt Yoakum found out during the week, Kurt Busch is usually outstanding in his field.
Now, how does a guy from Las Vegas end up as basically his own reality show of Kurt Busch Goes Country?
This is crazy. Just the whole city life of Vegas, you grow up in it and you see as quick as everything moves. And it doesn't necessarily burn you out, but it really keeps pace of just the high speed that we find on the racetrack. And to find a lower pace and just a slower pace.
I mean, slower pace, this is not like living in a subdivision. This is like Oliver Wendell Douglas from Green Acres somewhere could be out here plowing the back 40.
It's so different, and it's such a new vibe of life for everybody.
Green Acres is the place to be.
So they had an ice storm out here like 2 years ago, and we were cleaning up all the brush and getting things piled together. And we're like, dude, we're in the country now, so we're gonna set fire to it. Well, we had some moving boxes and moved some stuff around, and the box rolls down this field. You can see some of the trees still have some of the some of the damage from it. Brian, this whole thing's on fire. Grandma calls the fire department. And we had to come out and set, because all we had was a little spigot over there, this little hose.
So you had to like a little hose to try to put it out.
It was great. And the problem with everything is my dad's now on probation with the fire department in Mooresville or something like that, because he set fire without a permit. So it's just the adjustment from city life to country. We think we know what we're doing, but there's still just this common sense thing that we lose track of.
Well, I got me a firewife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on a riddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. Woo-hoo!
Obviously, you got to have a tractor.
If
you're going to be a farmer, you got to have a tractor. And I see also that you have made the hat switch.
Yes, I'm now Farmer Bush.
You missed like half of the row.
Yeah. For some reason, the PTO's not engaging all that well.
Now, is this your first time on the tractor?
Are you sure? It looks that way, doesn't it? For some reason, the PTO wasn't engaging, and we weren't cutting any grass. But you can see I cut grass the other day.
You could call the Sharpie crew to come in and pitch you here and help you
okay,
out.
Okay, this is why. This is why we're having an issue. I just figured it out. This is our bolt, and it has sheared.
Oh, yeah.
And this is what runs. Ah, you thought I was playing the whole time.
See, again, you broke the equipment.
Now we're getting it.
So what do you think about when you're mowing?
When you're on the tractor, you're making sure that you don't have to go and cut anything over again because you're going so damn slow. These are our two goats. They were generously given to us by the Petties, and they were from the petting zoo at the farm where they had all the kids for the Vixie Junction gang camp. All right, now goats are quick. Careful. Get in here. They might run out on you. And he fell for it. He's actually starting to mellow out, but yesterday you'd pick up the female, because she'll let you pick her up real easy. He'll get pissed because he can't see upward. I guess goats can't see up. So when you hold her up in the air, he starts wigging. He doesn't know where she went, what's going on. He thinks he's all by himself now, so it's the funniest thing. Let's see if he gets tweaked. He gets bent. See, you can see her now. He's starting to pick up on it.
So who cleans everything?
We've got a guy that
comes. Do you delegate that out?
We got a guy that comes out. It's me.
Thank God I'm a country boy, yeah!
Kurt Busch, farming and owning goats, it would kind of be like if Kid Rock actually played elevator music. You wouldn't expect it, and many expect you to win four straight here tonight. But what did your dad say to you earlier this week?
My dad's the biggest superstitious number guy there is in the world, and he said, you know how many races you've done well at, and then you know how many races you haven't done well, and I don't think it's your time this time around. I'm like, thanks, Dad, what's the deal?
So you quickly knock down wood.
Yeah, so you got to knock on wood, and each race is its new race, and Bristol, you don't know what's going to come out. Whatever it takes to get to victory lane, the team has to adjust to, so we'll see what we've got to make it to victory lane tonight.
His first win came from the 27th starting position here. He rolls off 24 tonight. He's won four of the last nine short track races. Bill?
Thank you, Matt. Greg Biffle started 24th last Sunday at Michigan and won. Today he starts 10th, his best Bristol finish 5th. Terry Labonte starts 12th. He's a two-time winner here. Terry is still chasing his first top five of the year. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Jeff Burton in his second race, driving the 30 car for Richard Childress. His best finish at Bristol, second. Carl Edwards finished 10th last week in his series debut. Wednesday, he won the truck race here. Tonight, he starts 25th. Lug nuts are like a crying baby on an airplane. How can something that small be such a pain in the neck? Both have to be very carefully handled, and both have to be changed several times during the day. Now, last Sunday at Michigan, an allegedly missing lug nut probably cost Mark Martin's team the win. It was a confusing and controversial call. Dave Burns is back with us. Dave, can you clear up this issue for us?
Well, there is no issue according to the sanctioning body, Bill. They made no rule changes. They didn't even discuss it in tonight's driver's meeting. This is a lug nut, and here's what an official is looking for when they make the subjective call that all of them are installed correctly. An official's looking for a tire changer to make 5 rhythmic hits with the wrench on the wheel. If there's anything short of that, a hesitation or a drop down to pick up a lug nut, they'll say put it on before you leave or bring you in the next lap and make you put it on. That loses you valuable time positions. positions on the track. Now to the word install. NASCAR put it in the rule book a few years ago saying all lug nuts must be installed. Bill looked it up so you don't have to. Basically, it means to establish or to fix in position for use. So lug nuts must be fixed in position to hold a wheel on. If not, NASCAR will call you back in and you'll have to make it right. I spoke to series director John Darby earlier this week, and he said if upon returning to pit road, all five lug nuts are on correctly, installed, they will try to reverse their decision. They will try to give you the position back on the track that you had before. But that didn't happen for Mark Martin last week. Running in the top five, he had to restart 28th. And Bill, hopefully this little installment of Dave Discovers helps keep him from being too torqued about lug nuts.
Very good, Dave. Thank you very much. Mark Martin finished second last week, obviously disappointed after the race, but in his post-race interview was polite and professional. He starts seventh tonight, 33 points out of the chase for the championship, and he's with Marty.
And what an amazing charge, Mark Martin, you made last week up to second place. Just all that you had to go through last week at Michigan kind of provide extra motivation for tonight.
Well, we want to win bad, you know, but this is Bristol, and this is a real wild card. A lot of strange things happen here, and, you know, I think we just want to get through this thing and not be in a wreck first and foremost, and then if we're around for the last 100 laps, maybe we can give them a run for it.
Mark Martin, a two-time winner here at the world's fastest half mile. Bill.
Thank you, Marty. One of the Bristol traditions, the parade of trucks heading into the track. It happened on Thursday night as the guys get ready for the weekend of racing here at Bristol. The fans love this. Another thing the fans love, their favorite driver. Now, we're not talking about the guy in the car on the track. We're talking about the guy that gets everything to the track. And as Benny Parsons found out after the race at Watkins Glen, the road home is lined with race fans.
Mike Knauer is the catch can man for Jimmy Johnson. Jeff Craven is a gas man for Jeff Gordon. But when the checkered flag falls, that signals the beginning of a new race, because these two guys, along with their co-drivers, help bring the cars and equipment back home.
You've got to be the envy of every truck driver you pass on the road.
Oh, absolutely. It's the people that talk to you on the radio are just, you know, they want your job.
And for some race fans, just seeing these 40-ton haulers is like connecting with their favorite driver.
I've had people follow me before 100 miles just wait for me to stop so they get pictures of the truck.
No place is that kind of support more evident than in Seelands Grove, Pennsylvania, 150 miles from the Watkins Glen racetrack. 3 hours after the race is over, their party is just beginning. You just come here to watch these trucks go by?
Yes. If we can't make it to the race, this is the next best thing.
Because we know that this is as close as we can really get to watching our favorite guys without having to pay money.
It's free.
This is as free as it gets.
How long have you been coming down here to watch these trucks go by?
4 or 5 years now.
They blow the horn, they throw frisbees, hats, shirts. We're just lucky people to be sent along Routes 15 getting stuff.
Did they throw you?
Oh, here comes the trailer, gotta go.
We got some crazy people down here in Pennsylvania.
I noticed that.
And you'll see these trucks crossing the country this week, heading for Fontana, California, for next Sunday's race under the lights in Fontana.
Discover Card Countdown to Green, brought to you by Discover Card. It pays to discover. And by Autolite Spark Plugs. It's time to change your plugs.
Tennessee native Sterling Marlin has never won at Bristol. His best finisher, second in August of 91. Tonight, he starts third, hoping to do exactly what Dale Earnhardt Jr. did last night. Matt.
And Dale Earnhardt Jr. won from the pole last night, trying for his third career weekend sweep. But you're starting all the way back here in 30th. How hard is it going to be to get to the front, Junior?
Well, I've seen a lot of people win races from the back here. You just got to have a great race car and be smart, not make any mistakes, try not to get tore up. It's going to be fun, you know. It's fun no matter where you're at Bristol. You're always racing somebody.
And he has never won deeper than 13th in the field. He will roll off 30th tonight.
Wait a minute.
What? Go ahead.
I got to wish my sister her happy 32nd birthday. So I love you, Kelly. Hope you hear this at home.
She's only 32nd? 32?
32, yeah. Believe that or not. So that makes me almost 30. So we're getting old.
To Marty Snyder.
Matt, speaking of 32, that's where Elliott Sadler finished last week. Kind of an unexpected setback for this race team. How critical is the top five tonight, Elliott?
Very critical, man. I hadn't slept at all this week. It's pretty the biggest nerve-wracking race I think I've ever had in my career. I know we got a good car, but things can happen fast here. And after last week, only 3 weeks left, man. Everything's so valuable, points are. But the M&M's Ford Taurus is fast. Just got to stay out of trouble, use my head. I've got to drive the best race I've ever driven in my career tonight to do what I think we need to do in the points to be successful.
Win number one for Elliott Sadler came right here at Bristol. Dave?
Kevin Harvick clings to a slim 46-point margin in the chase over 11th place, Jeremy Mayfield. You're trying to hang on. Can you do that tonight here at Bristol, a place where you've been very successful?
You guys need to worry about the guy in 10th. We're in 8th, if you guys haven't figured that out. But real proud of this whole Goodwrench team. We got Team Realtree on board tonight, and we're just going to keep doing what we're doing. We're not worried about the rest of it. The way it falls is the way it falls, and if we're in, we're in. We're out, we're out.
Kevin's number one here, but he's finished in the top 10 in 6 of his 7 starts here. Bill?
Thanks, Dave. As you've heard the guys talk about on the track, this can be a very dramatic night, especially when it comes to the racing version of the Rush Hour Hit and Run. Here's Wally Dallenbach.
Welcome to Bristol Motor Speedway. I'll tell you what, this place is intense. I can't think of anywhere that we go that you have to concentrate any harder. It's like being in the middle of a hornet's nest. But what I want to talk to you tonight about is the old bump and run. There's the right way and there's the wrong way. Now actually what you want to do is if you're going to do the bump and run, you want to get on somebody's bumper and you want to just tap them right about the middle of the corner or even getting off. What you're trying to do is just bring the traction to the rear of the car, slide them up in the racetrack and go. The other way, not so pretty, you can just pop them. Give them a pop once right in the middle of the corner and the car will really slide up the racetrack. Now the third way, and you don't want to do this unless you're really mad at the guy, is if you hit somebody going down into the corner, 9 times out of 10, there's no way that guy is going to be able to save that race car because you're going to spin him out and he's going to hit the wall. But the biggest trick of all is that you want to be on the giving end, not the receiving end.
Well, he said his mom always told him it was better to give than to receive, but I don't think she was talking about Bristol. Two-time Bristol winner Mark Martin starts 7th tonight. His last win came 11 races ago at Dover when he started 7th. Now, Mark is 12th in the championship standings. He's 27 points out of 11th and 11 points ahead of Ryan Newman. This season, he has 11 top 11 finishes. From August of 1994 to August of 1999, Mark Martin finished in the top 10 at Bristol 11 consecutive races. So when did Mark get his first Nextel Cup win here at Bristol? Exactly 11 years ago tonight, August 28th, 1993. That's something else you won't have to look up because we already did. Hero and the Sharpie 500 is coming up from Bristol.
This has been the Discover Card Countdown to Green. Let's go racing.
TNT Sports presents the Sharpie 500, live from the Bristol Motor Speedway in Bristol, Tennessee. 160,000 fans are here and many rooting for the guy with Matt Yocum.
Bill, you can feel the electricity in the air, and Rusty, your fans would love to see you score number 10 here on the high banks in Thunder Valley. How about this hot rod tonight?
And we had a good car. I feel real good about it. We might have to work on it a little bit, but it was good last night in practice, and man, I love to win number 10 for the fans. It'd be great.
He has scored career win number 1, career win number 50 here. He'd love to get number 56 tonight, Bill.
Matt, 500 laps for 43 drivers chasing just 10 precious positions and only 3 races to get it done. The pre-race ceremonies from Bristol, Tennessee are next on TNT.
Mama hits home on TNT with a fistful of Steven Seagal. The Patriot on deadly ground. Under Siege 2 and Fire Down Below. All Seagal, all weekend on TNT.
Freeze!
They're gonna put you in jail for the rest of your life.
Why did you kill her?
She deserved what she got.
You have the right to remain silent.
Wrangler Jeans Company, a new generation of Wrangler. New fits, new fabrics, new styles.
Tuesday, the most talked about comedy premiere on television.
Make me laugh!
From the makers of Shrek, an adult comedy for every species.
This isn't about color, so don't play the pink card.
Starring John Goodman, Cheryl Hines, Orlando Jones, and Carl Reiner. With guest stars Andy Richter and Lisa Kudrow.
Mr. Wright's the only man who loves me. Boogie-boogie-boo.
Help me.
The premiere of Father of the Pride, brought to you commercial-free, Tuesday 9 p.m. Eastern on NBC.
Have you heard? Alpacas are the livestock changing people's lives all across America.
I've always been an animal lover and have had several different types of livestock. And in the last 6 years, having the alpacas, it's been a wonderful family experience. The children have been involved in the day-to-day care. Overall, this has been an absolutely wonderful lifestyle for the kids and I.
Visit an alpaca farm today. To locate an alpaca farm near you, go to alpacainfo.com or call 1-800-213-9522.
The Sharpie 500 on TNT is brought to you by Sharpie, right out loud. By Nextel, coast-to-coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. By the next Ford Super Duty, tougher, stronger, smarter. And by Coca-Cola, let's make it real. TNT's live coverage of the Sharpie 500 continues from Bristol, Tennessee. For some guys, this tight mall. While for others, the opportunity has never been this big. Just three races remain in the race to the chase for the Nextel Cup. Tonight, it roars on for 500 laps on the high-banked half-mile Bristol Motor Speedway. 160,000 fans. They got here early. They will stay here late. They're rooting for their favorite driver. The sparks will fly. Let's take you trackside and join the pre-race ceremonies at Bristol.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise for today's invocation? Would you please rise for today's invocation to be delivered by Beth Yarborough of the Jonesboro Presbyterian Church?
Please pray with me. Almighty God, creator, maker of days, and crafter of lives, against the backdrop of the celebration of the events of this day, we pray to you, O God, whose power is evident in all that you have created. To you, O Lord, whose power is more than the propulsion of jets flying in formation. To you, whose power is greater than the roar of gathered engines racing for the finish line. We pray today for your safe keeping of all who are gathered here, especially our drivers. We have traveled many paths to be here, but in our vast differences, we are bound together in one undeniable commonality, one united, urgent desire for peace, peace in our lives and peace in our world. To that end, we pray for the grace to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you. Amen.
Please remain standing for the presentation of colors by the Air Force Combat Climatology Center of Asheville, North Carolina. And please join in the singing of our national anthem with the children of Motor Racing Outreach.
By the dawn's early.
these kids and some very proud parents talking to some of the drivers in the garage area before the race. They were more nervous about the national anthem than they were about 500 laps here at the half-mile Bristol Motor Speedway. Let's check back out on the grid with Marty.
The best national anthem in the whole series, and Tony Stewart's been pretty electrifying himself. You feel the excitement building here. Two wins in the last six races. Is the car good enough for another win tonight, Tony?
I hope so. I mean, Zippy and all the guys on the Home Depot team, you know, brought another good car. I mean, this is the race where we normally get going good. So, you know, hopefully we'll keep going again.
Tony Stewart making career start. Bill.
Marty, there have been 87 Nextel Cup races at Bristol. In the spring of 2001, Elliott Sadler won from 38th, the deepest in the field any winner has ever started here. Where will the winner come from tonight? We are 7 minutes away from the green flag for the Sharpie 500. The excitement builds in the stands, 160,000 strong. On pit road, the final moments of calm for driver and crew. 7 minutes from now, racing returns to its deepest roots, the best in the business on the biggest short track anywhere. And now it's time to send it way up there to the guys that are sky high, ready to call the Sharpie 500. Alan Bestwick, Wally Dallenbach, and Benny Parsons. Enjoy it, you guys.
We didn't realize that no being afraid of heights was a prerequisite for this job when we took it to come here. Bill, if you can't feed off the energy here at Bristol, you can't get excited about a race anywhere. This crowd is charged up, and we're ready to go. Benny's a former winner here. He wants to talk real estate and some delicate negotiations over property that can make or break or night.
It's just those few feet going down in the corners, turns one and turn three. The car on the inside is dependent on that guy on the outside to give him room. As Michael Waltrip gives a 21 car, Ricky Rudd room. And we'll see this all night long, car on the outside. 19, Jeremy Mayfield gives Kevin Harvick room. But later in the race, and if that leader comes up behind to lap these cars, we'll see tougher negotiations. We'll see all these guys coming down in front. The rear guys going to hit them in the rear. They're going back in the wall. And then all parties going to be angry.
All these reality shows are all the rage on television. We've kind of got our own version of a racing reality show here tonight, Wally, where somebody might get voted off the island.
Yeah, this is Bristol. I mean, you're going to bump, you're going to rub. Guys are going to be mad. Guys are going to be shoving. There's going to be a lot of finger pointing, and that's just in the booth here. But I'll tell you what, when they looked at the point system on this deal, the new point system, all the drivers and all the crew chiefs, I think, looked at Bristol. This is the one they're worried about. They're sweating it. They want to get out of here and be lucky and not lose a lot of points.
So the record for cautions here is 20. The average is 9.
I'll have the over-under at 12.
The over-under at 12 for caution flags. All right. The energy, the intensity, the excitement that is NASCAR racing at Bristol is about to be unleashed before some 160,000 fans. Let's go trackside for the command to start engines.
For the words we've all been waiting for, Sharpie 500 Grand Marshal Linda Fabry.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
Fans have been coming in since early this morning. They filled the campground since early this week. And all ready to see 500 laps of racing here at Bristol Motor Speedway on the world's fastest half mile. Jeff Gordon won his sixth Bud Pole Award of the season in qualifying on Friday. Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR, proud to sponsor the Budweiser Pole Award, given to the fastest qualifier at each NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race. Budweiser congratulating Jeff Gordon, the latest Budweiser Shootout eligible driver. And here we go with a look at the starting lineup for tonight's Sharpie 500. Jeff Gordon with Casey Kane on the front row. Kane's car repaired after a crash in practice yesterday. No laps in the final practice.
Has to be a little bit of apprehension in his camp. 40 car Sterling Mahon, his best start of the year. Third spot.
Just heard from Tony Stewart. He's going to share row number three with Jamie McMurray. Jamie finished third this race 1 year ago. One of those guys in the race to the chase.
Another guy on the inside, Mark Martin, has been unbelievable the last three or four races. Can he continue here at Bristol on Saturday night?
Row five, it's Jeremy Mayfield and Greg Biffle, last week's winner up in Michigan. Mayfield, 10th place here a year ago. He could use that. Another one of those guys in that race to the chase. The outsiders, as it were.
And Jimmy Johnson. Oh, he's got to stop the bleeding. Three straight. He's fallen out of and crashed yesterday in practice.
Rusty Wallace, 9-time Bristol winner. Finished second in March. He'll be tough tonight. Dale Jarrett, 4th in points over the last 10 races, trying to get into that top 10.
Jeff Burton, second start in that 30 AOL car, alongside his brother, Ward Burton.
There's Brendan gone, Robbie Gordon. Robbie usually gets around this place pretty good. He's pretty fast here.
Brendan's car repaired after also a crash qualifying yesterday, excuse me. Bobby Labonte, one career victory on short tracks, looking for two tonight, trying to stop a little slide he's been on lately.
Kevin Harvick, 6-10, six straight top 10 finishes for Harvick.
There's the two guys that are going to be real tough tonight.
Kurt Busch going for four in a row.
Carl Edwards, 10th in his first ever Cup start a week ago at Michigan. He shares row 13 with Ken Schrader.
Jeff Green, fastest in happy hour. Pretty good. Kenny Wallace, driver for Michael Waltrip.
And there's Junior outside of row 15. If he wins tonight, have to start 30th spot.
Ricky Rudd, new crew chief this week. Michael Fatback McSwain now heading the effort for the 21 Motorcraft car.
Scott Wimmer and Tony Raines. Take out row 17.
Michael Waltrip in a backup car. He will be dropping to the tail of the field. He had a nasty crash yesterday.
In qualifying, Nemechek Spencer back in row 19. We still have more cars. I tell you what, Scott Riggs had a good car yesterday. They found something in happy hour. Crew told me picked up almost half second.
And that is a happy hour, then.
Yes, very happy.
Mike Wallace in the field with Derek Cope and Morgan Shepherd. Final spot in tonight's field for the Sharpie 500. There are the guys who failed to qualify. 48 drivers tried to get the 43 spots in the field. And we told you about Waltrip and Jimmy Johnson. Ricky Craven also going to the rear of the field by his own choice. Is the word we get from race control.
Who was that?
Ricky Craven. We'll have to follow up on that and find out what's up there. So there we go. The three parade and pace laps underway before the green flag. Let's check down on pit road before things get really noisy down there. Go ahead, Marty.
That's a good opposite directions. Matt Kenseth has been running great lately. He has five straight finishes of six or better here at Bristol, driving his oldest race car and one of his favorite race cars, and the car is very good. Meanwhile, Bobby Labonte, ninth in the championship standings, just 13 points ahead of 11th place. Jeremy Mayfield told me his car just a moment ago, not very good, but he's confident in the changes they made this morning. Matt.
Marty, there's a sense of urgency here in the Everingham camp. Now, both of Ray's cars are trying to lock down spots in that top 10. Last week, they swapped spots. Now, Kane is 10th, Mayfield 11th. Mayfield has never won a short track race in Cup. Kane's never won, period. They know tonight their key to getting a shot at that championship is surviving. Both cars start in the top 10 tonight, and that's where they're hoping they finish. Dave?
Matt, Dale Jarrett and team have really picked things up over the last nine races. Four finishes of third or better have put him 14th in the championship, just 58 markers out of the chase. Good time to come to Bristol, a place of much success for Dale, including a win in this race in 1997. Bill?
There we go. Very loud here at Bristol. Dave, I took an informal survey in the garage this afternoon, talking to guys in the top 15 in the championship standings. If I promised you a finishing position, would you just sit it out and go home? If you promised them 15, they basically wanted a race. If you promised them 10th place points, they said they'd load it up and go home. The guys that are gamblers are going to run for it. The guys protecting their points said 15. No, I don't think so. Alan. Clever, you change quick, kind of like Superman, huh? Yeah, well, good thing it's a short track. Didn't have far to go here, yeah. Alan.
There you go.
Well, here it is.
Here it is.
160,000 fans in this most spectacular racing stadium, all gathered around to see what kind of action tonight we'll get, all heightened by this race to the chase. There is going to be some tension on pit road.
And the fans love this race. This is the most sought-after ticket in all of NASCAR Nextel Cup racing. It's hard to get these tickets, but when they get them, they keep them.
And by the way, just a correction, the number we were given was wrong on the car going to the back by his own choice. It's the 37 Page instead of the 32 of Ricky Craven. There are the numbers on the night, 166 and a half miles. Very slow pit road speed here.
And that pit window, we'll see some gamblers at the end of the race at lap 325, 330. We might see some guys pit and try to make it the rest of the way, hoping on some caution flags.
First things first, let's get there.
Yeah, that's right. But that's the first thing they got to do is, you're right, get there.
Half a lap from the green, inside the car, the driver just before the start here at Bristol.
I'll tell you what, you want to be, if you're in Robbie's car right there, you're trying to think about getting to the inside. That's the main thing. You've got to get down low because that's the fast way around here.
Butterflies?
Nah, the butterflies are gone. You just want to get going, and you're just anxious to get the car down on the bottom and hope you don't get run over.
Once you get inside that car and they say start your engines, butterflies basically leave.
Pace cars left as well. And we are underway in the Sharpie 500 at Bristol.
See, Elliott Sadler, the first guy really on the outside, hanging out there right now. He wants to get down to the bottom, believe me, as bad as he can. And now's his chance.
Sadler squeezing in line in front of Jeremy Mayfield. Jeff Gordon leads, Casey Kane second, Sterling Marlin third, Ryan Newman fourth, Tony Stewart is fifth. Then you get McMurray, Martin, and then Sadler in sixth, seventh, and eighth.
See, Biffle hung out there. And this is just like Daytona Talladega. If you get hung out just like the draft, you have to let, and fortunately, a nice guy like Terry Labonte will give you some room, but there's a lot of guys that won't give you that spot so you can get down on the bottom. Yeah, there's patience, like BP talked about. They're using patience now, but it runs out every lap.
On board Rusty Wallace. This is 10th place. And the race for fourth, Ryan Newman showing Tony Stewart a little bit of room on the inside.
Oh, and Jamie McMurray, 42, a little loose as he exited turn two. But a 12 car starting to go up in the middle of the corner. Now, here's what exactly what I was talking about. This time, Ryan Newman decided, I'm going to give Tony Stewart the inside.
Problem is, he's going to lose a lot of spots by doing that.
Rusty Wallace trying to hold his turf as well. Here's Tony Stewart by Ryan Newman, McMurray, Martin, and Sadler lined up there.
They'll probably have to wait until Jeremy Mayfield goes by. Then he's got room to get back in line. Unless he gets lucky and can get down there before that.
And folks, these drivers are just like vultures. They see a spot and they all dive for it. Bill, what about the 12 car? What are you saying? Anything?
A lot of changes on that car this morning, Benny, because it was too free in and tight in the center. The only thing they didn't change, the front springs and the nose weight. Ryan knew he'd had his hands full when they started the race.
Well, it looks like it's tight now, Bill.
So Newman shuffled back to eighth place. Just ahead of Jeremy Mayfield. Ahead of him, you see Tony Stewart now shoved up into the outside lane. McMurray's gone by. Martin has gone by. Sadler has gone by. And now Stewart ducking into line in front of Newman.
In a situation like that, if you know you've got a spot, you're better off just getting out of the throttle and letting those cars go by so you can get back down the line.
That is going to put Tony Stewart back to seventh place and Newman in eighth.
And we talked about the give and take. Right now, all these guys are being gentlemen. But the leader, Jeff Gordon, is about to start lapping cars. And as he starts working through those cars, when he gets up close to the front, there he is, and the cars that he's starting to lap on the state straightaway. When he gets some of those fast cars, that's when they stop giving. That's when they try to stay in front of that leader, Jeff Gordon, trying desperately to stay in the lead lap.
Jeff coming up in the back of Derek Cope's car, the 42nd place machine, as Kevin Page is pulled off track and is going into the garage.
And BP, that's one thing about it, too. You think, well, okay, he's going to pass me, I'll be the lucky dog, but the lucky dog will change every lap.
Exactly.
Matt?
The 9 car, Casey Kane, crashed this Dodge car in the first of two sessions on Friday evening. He didn't get a chance to go out for happy hour. The Dodge boys came in early today, spent a lot of time repairing the right side of this race car and also changing out a lot of the suspension components. So far, Casey's not said a word on the radio, which is good. And if you're owner Ray Evernham, the other good thing, Casey was able to get down to the bottom and try now to follow one of the masters here at Bristol, and that's Jeff Gordon.
So, Kane. and Marlin there working in tandem, trying to keep up with Jeff Gordon.
One thing about conversations here, too, there's not a whole long conversation when you're in this race. You push the button, you say a couple of words, and that's it, because that's all you have time for.
Yeah, about all you can say is loose, tight.
Loose in, loose off, or whatever. Yeah.
So Jeff Gordon beginning to catch the tail end of the field. Caution free through the first 17 laps. We'd had about three yellows by this time last night, hadn't we?
Yeah.
And you're watching NASCAR on TNT. Okay, so I jinxed it. Caution is out here at Bristol. Jimmy Spencer bounced off the wall exiting turn two and then couldn't get a break in traffic to get down to pit road, so stopped on the racetrack. And now he's on the pit lane, getting service to his car.
He's up there in that high slippery stuff, especially coming off the corners right there. Not a whole lot of grip there.
I tell you what, he hit that wall pretty doggone hard because they're three wide, and we all know that two wide here at Bristol barely fits.
I tell you what, that guard stood his ground over there. Behind the wall, he never moved.
So Spencer in trouble early, bringing out the first yellow. Rusty Wallace is on pit road. Rusty had slid way back from 13th starting spot to 24th, and he's the first of the cars to pit. See Rusty coming around to this front stretch pit road. Remember the two pit roads here at Bristol, and you've got to roll through both of them under the caution flag. We'll update the pit stops when we come back under caution for the first time in the Sharpie 500. So impressive the sight, the Bristol Motor Speedway, where the Sharpie 500 runs tonight under the lights before some 160,000 fans. Race under caution, here's our Miller Lite NASCAR Nextel Cup race fact. Drivers starting on pole position have finished 22nd or lower in five of the last seven Bristol NASCAR Nextel Cup races.
I hope no one told Jeff Gordon that.
Well, he probably doesn't want to hear that. Jeff Gordon, though, won this race from the pole in 2002. Ended a long, windless streak for him. I guess bottom line in Bristol is stay out of trouble, no matter where you start.
Well, at least Jeff Gordon now for 15, 20 laps will not have to worry about lap traffic again. Sterling Marlin has gotten a second spot by Casey Kane.
Coming to the green, none of the front runners pitted. Guys who did stop as we go for the restart. Rusty Wallace, Bobby Labonte, Ricky Craven, Jimmy Johnson, Todd Bodine, Scott Wimmer, Michael Waltrip, Joni Maciek, Tony Raines, and Scott Riggs. First off of pit road among that group is Rusty Wallace. He restarts 30th.
Oh, Robbie Gordon, that 31 car, hung on the outside.
Yeah, he had a great start, and he passed a couple of cars on the restart. He passed them high. A couple of guys were sleeping. And he fortunately got back in line. He was bouncing off of Dale Jarrett there in 3 and 4.
We also tell you that Jimmy Spencer's taking his car behind the wall. He was going to be held a lap by NASCAR for intentionally bringing out a caution for stopping on the track. And now the damage on the car requires him to go behind the wall anyway.
On board, Robbie. Looking back at Dale Jarrett. Cool shot.
Cool. And we can see Robbie Gordon had some trouble getting off that corner. We heard him get back in the accelerator, back off, and then back in the throttle. You know, that's not good. You got to get in and stay in all the way off the corner.
Those tires spin.
Hell yeah. Spinning forward and sideways. It's hard to get the power down sometimes when you're driving straight off the corner, and most of the time you're driving off the corner sideways.
And Casey Kane, our outside pole sitter, has fallen back to the sixth position.
Yeah, Sterling Marlin got by, then McMurray, then Martin, then Sattler. And now Casey trying to hold his position in front of Tony Stewart and Ryan Newman.
See, he's lost some ground too. Elliott Sattler, as they are driving away from him.
For a guy with a crashed race car, starting the race with no practice laps on it after it was rebuilt, falling back, not a surprise, but Matt, it doesn't look like it's too bad for him right now.
He is hanging in there. In fact, his crew chief Tommy Baldwin keeps giving him encouragement every few laps, saying, you are doing a great job. He's hanging there, trying. He's got a cash on the race turn one.
Joe Nemechek.
Caution, caution.
And Scott Wimmer. And Nemechek hit a ton.
I can hear that from here.
Wow.
Oh, that.
A lot of damage to that car, but you see Wimmer's car is drivable, barely. There's no water in it, so he won't be able to drive it far. What's going on with the 01?
Nemechek had just pitted, which put him way back in line. He did radio into his crew. Man, I thought I had it clear.
Uh-oh, sound like he...
Yeah, one of those arguing for space things.
Exactly, real estate's argument.
There's Joe right there. Well, that was Wimmer and Craven.
Oh, I see what happened.
And then Joe just...
Watch that hit.
Barely
hit.
Missed.
Bang. Oh, my goodness.
That was a shot.
Oh, boy. Caution is out here at Bristol. USA Today is the place for a comprehensive look at motorsports. Get all the latest stats, standings, and race results to keep up with your favorite teams and drivers. Pick up a copy of USA Today every day. It's not a full moon night. I believe that's tomorrow or Monday, but it could act like a full moon night tonight here at Bristol.
So far.
As we look down on Thunder Valley, Bristol Motor Speedway, the sounds of stock cars echoing off the hills tonight. Right now, they're at reduced throttle, though, under the second caution of the Sharpie 500.
But so far, we haven't seen anything that's going to cause any finger-pointing and anger in the pit area, because everything that's happened so far has been that driver's problem.
Well, we talked earlier about, you know, the cars being loose, or it's hard to get the power down off the corners. Well, I think that's what happened here with Scott Wimmer. He just got a little bit loose off the turn two. Unfortunately, we talked about this too. There's other guys that get caught up in a wreck. Let's watch here. Wimmer in front of Ricky Craven. He gets a little bit sideways. Craven goes by. Waltrip gets by.
No caution, no caution.
Unfortunately, Nemechek doesn't.
No, he almost makes it. Watch this. Now watch the sparks off Nemechek's car as he goes across the 48.
Good job, Jimmy.
And that's the thing. That's what you're afraid of at Bristol, is getting caught up in somebody else's wreck.
Still cleaning up some of the bits and pieces of debris down in turn one, so let's take advantage of the extended caution to squeeze in another break. Back at Bristol Motor Speedway, live coverage of the Sharpie 500, NASCAR on TNT. The race to the chase, just three left before the cutoff for that race for the next L Cup. Caution extended while they pick up some of the debris and so on. One of the reasons why it's difficult here at Bristol is because the track is so small and the field's so big.
So on the caution flag, they're almost all the way around the racetrack. You see, that's the only clear spot. So the workers go out, they have about 15, 20 seconds to try to pick up debris, and then the field comes back again. They got to wait till everyone goes by. And they got to be careful to get up all this debris, because debris is what causes flat tires.
And with 39 of the starters still on the racetrack, all in single file, they're scattered a pretty good ways around the racetrack. Coming to the restart, Jeff Gordon, the leader.
Kyle Petty on pit road, coming off pit road, but he has to maintain that 30 mile per hour speed limit, so he is lapped and probably will lose another lap to Jeff Gordon.
One of the front runners pitted under the yellow. Dale Earnhardt Jr. was the first one who did. Some of the guys at the back of the line. Jr. was 26th. Then you have Kenny Wallace, Todd Lamont, Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Green, Kyle Petty, and Scott Riggs came down pit road under this yellow.
Labonte hung up there on the outside, DP. Maybe a while before he gets back down.
That's right. Robbie Gordon got by. That Dale Jarrett's going by and Ward Burton. He's right there. Again, the vulture thing. Open the spot up. Oh, Terry Labonte gets back to the bottom.
That's going to put Terry in 14th. Dale Jarrett passed him for 13th. That's kind of the pressure point in line. You know, when you get the broad view of this Bristol racetrack, when you look down on it from as high as we are, you can always pick out that pressure point where there's a guy just a little bit quicker than the guy in front of him, and it kind of stacks the traffic up. Everything pretty well evenly spaced there. No real great pressure on the front bumper or back bumper of any of these guys, but You find that one spot in line where there's somebody right up against somebody, and they usually stack up behind him.
See, all those cars are content just around the racetrack. But now we've got Kurt Busch. He's back. He is not content. He wants to get by these cars, get closer to the front. And he's got that very aggressive stance behind that car, letting him know, I want by as quick as I can.
It's Casey Mears, Kurt, who's working on from 20th place. Here's Kurt going for a fourth straight win here in Bristol.
And see these cars moving around like this, and that's how it feels inside the race car, too. These cars move all over the racetrack at Bristol. There's a lot of, you know, bouncing around and twisting. And you're doing it every 15-second laps. Go ahead.
Marty, what's going on with the 97? What's he saying to the guys?
Everybody all at once, BP. Kurt has won, obviously, the last three races here, all with this race car he's driving tonight. Jimmy Finney told me this morning it is at least as good or better tonight than it was in the three previous races here. Kurt very happy with it so far. He's just a little bit too tight, but still very happy.
He's got right now, he is in traffic. He might be as fast as Jeff Gordon if he can get up there, but right now he's about 0.4 seconds slower, so therefore he's in 30-35 laps. If something doesn't happen, he's in danger of being lapped.
But don't you worry about Kurt Busch too much. In his four wins at Bristol, the earliest he's ever led a race was lap 3:59.
Really?
His mode of operating, they get to the front late, usually with a tire strategy thing, and then he never gives up the lead from there.
Ward Burton gets kicked up to the outside in that zero car. It's 25. Vickers goes by. Brendan gone in 77. We see Matt Kimball.
Oh, there's a little bit of here, take that. You're not giving me enough room. Because the 77 car, I think, drove up on the zero car of Burton.
And just behind them, Matt Kenseth's back bumper got hit by Casey Mears in that little jam up as well. Kenseth running back in 19th position. Dave, you got an update on Kenseth?
Now, this track may look symmetrical, but it acts very different in turns 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 for Matt Kenseth right now. 1 and 2, he has to baby the throttle. It doesn't handle real weather, very loose. In 3 and 4, though, he can put the hammer down and drive it right off the corner.
So Matt trying to chip his way toward the front from pretty deep in the suit. Working on Ward Burton for 18th place.
And there again, Ward, oh, a little bump as they came off the corner, but Ward realizes his car is...
Oh, watch it, Ward.
They started to argue on that spot, didn't they?
Yeah.
Look at the jam up behind him now. There's that Vultures thing again.
Yeah.
Mike Wallace will drive the 09 car, the black car in. Carl Edwards, 99, almost get together coming off turn 4.
When they get together in a bunch like that, that's when something bad happens.
Oh, there we go.
What was I saying?
Something about getting in a bunch, something bad happens.
Ricky Rudd squeezed into the wall, and the caution flag is out.
Side damage.
That was not the result that Rudd was hoping for tonight, now that he is reunited with crew chief Michael McSwain.
Look to me like he hit that wall off.
We're all coming in this time.
These cars, I mean, you can't underestimate how much these guys are sliding around. And when you run side by side and you're sliding around like that, it just takes a little bit of slide to get up into somebody, and that happens.
Ricky did not realize that Mike Wallace was on his outside. He came off the corner like there was not a car there, but unfortunately, Wallace was there.
That was a race for 23rd position, and Rudd and Mike Wallace both with damage. Now that's the backstretch pit road, and the leaders will come around to the front. Dave?
Sterling Marlin will go there now. He's already out of his pits. Two tire stop on the right side. Air pressure adjustment, a little tight up. They're going to try to see how it works, Matt.
Mark Martin's in. They're going to go for a four tire change. Meanwhile, the car in front of him, Casey Kane, two tires. No adjustments on the six of Martin. To Marty.
Jamie McMurray having a top five run. The very last car on pit road, middle of your screen he will be. A little free in, a little tight off, half pound in the right rear to fix that tight off condition for Jamie McMurray, actually in the middle of your screen. Bottom of the screen, Elliott Sadler, his car tight two, half pound in the right rear, up on the track bar. Bill.
Jeff Gordon all the way around pit road to the number one stall. Car's a little free off. This will be a four tire stop. He's going to be behind the guys that took two. Taking a long time compared to the other guys. He's on his way behind the six.
It looks like Mark Martin might have beaten him out with four tires.
Yeah, the only one I want to check on, Casey Kane and Ryan Newman. I think they both got two tires. And we know Sterling Marlin did. And then Mark Martin out ahead of Jeff Gordon. Some guys have not pitted, like Rusty Wallace, who will be the new leader of the Sharpie 500 when we return to Bristol. Sharpie 500, Bristol Motor Speedway, NASCAR on TNT, under caution for the third time in the race, about to go back to green. Wendy's race menu next weekend. A new Labor Day tradition starts for NASCAR, the California Speedway. Under the lights, 7 o'clock Eastern time, prime time next week. And then the Race to the Chase ends at Richmond, Saturday night, September 11th. A little short track racing to decide who gets into the chase for the next L Cup. Now, strategy for track position being played out here. Rusty Wallace is your leader. Remember, he pitted earlier. Dale Jr. second, Bobby Labonte third, Jimmy Johnson fourth, Kenny Wallace fifth, Scott Riggs sixth. None of those drivers pitted under this yellow. Sterling Marlin, Casey Kane, Ryan Newman, seventh, eighth, and ninth. Right side tires only on their pit stops, followed by Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon in line.
But that strategy is such, oh, look at Jr. just close up right on the back bumper of Rusty Wallace. A car looks pretty good right now, Marty.
Down pit road this time. They only had 12 laps on their tires. They pitted on lap 37 because it gets them into a window to finish on two more stops in this race. Already playing fuel strategy early here at Bristol. 48 cars back behind him. Jimmy Johnson, they pitted a couple of times during this race. Day two at lap 37. His car was tight. They went down the track bar. Jimmy said, I love the changes you made, Chad. The car is much better.
Gordon Ryan Newman with an almost in turn three.
Well, that was one of those bumps. You talked about it on your pre-race show, Wally's World, the bump and run on Ryan Newman.
Newman shuffled back. Gordon passed Mark Martin. Now McMurray is past Martin. Now Newman's on the outside and getting hung out.
Ah, Tony cuts him some slack. But I don't know if Newman can keep his car down on the bottom of the racetrack. It looks like he's struggling, not able to hook that bottom line.
Remember, he got just the two tires on that pit stop, matching up the new right sides and the older left sides.
Here comes the old bump and run. You see Jeff Gordon get in there right underneath. Just hangs the bumper. Well, and then hangs it a little bit more. Didn't get it good enough the first time.
There's that real estate thing. Casey Mears just skidded off the racetrack onto pit road down the backstretch. I believe he's missing part of his right front.
Oh, the lot of damage to the hood of that car.
Got hit to somebody.
Radiator is broken. They said take it behind the wall, I'm sure is what they said.
So tough luck there for Casey Mears.
It looks like Rusty hasn't really lost a whole lot on Earnhardt Jr. Once he let him by, he kind of got back down in line. And
as a matter of fact, that lap, Rusty Wallace was faster than Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Well, we talked about in Wally's World, and you mentioned it a minute ago, the bump and run. How about we fire up the Singular Wireless Race Talk poll? That is the topic tonight. What do you think about the bump and run in terms of fairness? Anything goes to win. It's okay as long as you don't wreck the guy. Or it's dirty racing. Cast your vote. Let us know what you think.
It's all of the above.
Well, we get opinions.
Now, Rusty Wallace is coming right back on the 8 car. He must be happy now, huh, Bill?
You got to yell, hey, Bill!
Oh, it's noisy down there, right?
Yeah.
It's hard to hear.
Okay.
Hey, Bill, is Rusty Wallace happy?
There I am. I heard you. You just couldn't hear me. Well, you're buying that. Hey, he pitted on that first car because his car was just very, very loose. They made an air pressure adjustment. He said it's gotten a tick better. They stayed out for track position, and now it does seem to be improving.
Okay. So nine-time Bristol winner Rusty Wallace running second. Change for third. Here comes Sterling Marlin. Moving up through the guys that did not pit. By Jimmy Johnson, by Bobby Labonte. And he better be in a hurry because Jeff Gordon is starting to roll. This racing, Marty is with Joe Nemechek, who had that hard crash a little while ago. Marty?
Yeah, finally from the infield care center. You okay, and what happened?
I'm okay. You know, I have to say my pride's hurt. Bruised the bone on my foot. You know, just got clipped there at the last second right in the bumper cover and turned me around the wrong way and hit my foot a little bit.
That would be in his left foot. He's going to go home tomorrow and have it evaluated, but he's able to walk now.
So good news there that Joe is basically okay. A very hard crash in turn one. This is a race for seventh place. Seventh, eighth, ninth. McMurray in seventh in the 42. You're riding with Mark Martin in eighth.
And Casey Kane, Wally, is doing a very good job. He's showing some patience right now. He doesn't have a car good enough to run with these guys. He's moving over, letting them go. Don't argue that real estate.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And that's smart. That's smart racing here, especially this time. You get to start racing these guys side by side, and that's when you really lose a lot of ground. And you see Jimmy Johnson move up the racetrack for his partner, probably team owner.
Older tires, too, on that 48. A little bit of patience being shown here by Jimmy. Marty?
Yeah, he's trying to be as patient as he can. Remember, they have to start the back of the field in a backup car, and they have deemed in the front grill. They've had to take most all the tape off the front grill for Jimmy Johnson, especially on the right side, trying to get air to that engine.
Mark Martin dove underneath the 48, now chasing down the 42. Before that stop, he said the car was loose on entry and loose on exit and pushing slightly in the center of the corner. But it didn't really feel like there was any big deal, no adjustments. In fact, Pat Tyson told me today they just want to settle in, whether it's 4th, 6th, 8th, or even 15th, and just ride. Wally, as a driver, do you break this race into two separate segments, maybe 400 laps of survival?
Hang on, got trouble. Turn 4. Ricky Craven has looped around, caught the wall with the back end of the time ride, and the yellow flag flies again. He didn't catch it hard, but he didn't catch it.
It just kept getting looser and looser.
And finally, it gets so loose that you back it in the wall.
Now I got a right rear.
Right rear is flat.
So what has been a miserable summer continues for Maine's favorite racing son.
I'm not sure Ricky didn't have a... No, tires up there. That just looked really strange when he... You know, we saw a lot of guys have problems, though, in turn three over the weekend.
So,
like a bump down there or something.
Fourth caution out in the Sharpie 500 at Bristol. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Sharpie 500 night in Bristol, Tennessee, and the fans are here, 160,000 strong, having a great time watching the stars of the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series try to conquer this high-banked little bull ring. Last night, the NASCAR Busch Series drivers tried to conquer it. It was Earnhardt Jr. who came out on top. Dominating run, led 125 of 250 laps. Kyle Busch gaining a little more ground on Martin Truex in their race for the championship. 10 races to go for the Busch Series. They're at California Speedway next Saturday. Wednesday night, the Craftsman Truck Series raced here, and Carl Edwards came from the back to the front to score the win. His third of the season, 9 races to go in the Craftsman Truck Series Championship. They race at Richmond 1 week from Thursday. And Carl out there tonight in his Roush Racing 99 in 22nd place, his first cup go here at Bristol, and his second ever Nextel Cup Series race, period.
Okay, here we go. Car's all lined up, ready for the restart.
Green flag.
Oh, look at Junior with the restart.
Hey, man, he did that last night in the Busch race.
Tell you what, he'll put a lot
of... Oh, trouble front stretch. Brendan gone. Tony Raines.
Kyle Petty.
And Kyle Petty.
Man. See, they were only running half speed, and look at all the damage to Brendan's car.
Well, half speed would still be 50 miles an hour, right?
There's going to be plenty of real estate to race on if they keep doing this.
Well, there is.
So yellow flag number 5.
Somebody checks. Well, let's see. Normally somebody checks up on a restart, and that's what happens. Looks like what happened.
Very good, Wally.
Crunch, clunk. A lot of damage to the 99 and 49, looks to me like.
17 couldn't get going. The 99 checked up. The 77 didn't. Chain reaction.
And there are a couple of radiators whose contents have been scattered around this half-mile track. And the cleanup crews will go to work once again. 90 of 500 laps complete before a sold-out house in Bristol.
Thank you.
TBS College Football Cruiser that's going to appear at all their games this fall.
We didn't have that cruiser last week, did we?
No, we didn't. We could have used it.
What was that cruiser when we were camping, when we were camping in Michigan?
Yeah.
We had the leprechaun.
Big 12 and Pac-10 college football on TBS this fall. Got a great lineup of games. Dale Earnhardt Jr., the race leader, under caution. Marty, your turn to speak.
Leading the field around very slowly here at lap 93 for Dale Earnhardt Jr., trying for his first ever Bristol win, his best finish here, third in this race 2 years ago. Here's what he has to say about the Budweiser number 8.
I need a little more grip in the left rear. I'm a little bit snug, but I'm sliding the back a little bit too much. I'd like to be a little more comfortable. I can't run, you know, long runs. I make a lot more mistakes with it like that. Every once in a while, it'll jump out on me.
And how do you fix that? Wanting more grip in the left rear, you take a pound out of all the tires except the left rear, giving the left rear more grip. Bill?
Marty, 9-time Bristol winner Rusty Wallace hasn't had a top 10 finish since the Coca-Cola 600 at Charlotte in May. 43rd here last year, second here in the spring, fighting a little bit loose off right now. Used track position and stayed out under this caution. Dave?
Marlin was fourth here in the spring, Bill, and having a good run here tonight. That two-tire change to the right side worked pretty good. Sterling said it had started out a little bit tight, but the car is really coming in now. Matt?
Mark Martin chasing his third win here in Thunder Valley. He said the car was neutral on entry, then it went to tight in the center, and then loose on exit, but he's still very pleased with the race car. Remember back to last week, he finished second, but it was a very hard-fought second-place finish. He was part of that Superheroes campaign while the team brought out Batman. Hey, if anything works, keep doing it.
So Mark Martin soldiering along in sixth place, hoping his Batmobile runs well here tonight, looking for a good finish to continue his pursuit of a spot in the Race to the Chase. In addition to winning the race a week ago at Michigan, Greg Biffle's team spent the least amount of time on pit road among participating crews, so they win the McDonald's Drive-Thru Pit Crew Championship, fueled by Powerade. 20,000 to them. Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s team with a slim lead in the season-long standings.
It's a close race right there.
200,000 on the line for the crews. They know about the money. Kind of got a little racing mash set up back in the garage area in the center of the infield here at Bristol. All the wrecks being repaired.
See Morgan Shepherd's car, Brendan Gaughan's car. I see Tony Raines' 51 car.
Tucked in behind a hauler you can't see quite there. Ken Schrader's, there's Kyle Petty's, there's Casey Mears. And it's early.
So they're earning their money already tonight.
Got to fix it. Got to try and get back out.
Got to get those points.
So here we come to the restart. Got something for us, Bill?
Just a lot of talk about how slow Earnhardt Jr. brings him to the restart.
Green flag.
Oh, he got a wow. Pretty good jump there.
Junior able to hold him off.
Rusty was ready for that restart, wasn't he?
Yeah, sometimes that bringing it down that slow will work against you because it's not like Rusty Wallace is going to take advantage of that.
Earnhardt Jr. leads. Wallace is second. Marlin third. Jeff Gordon fourth. McMurray fifth.
And Gordon is all over the back of Sterling Marlin. Sterling Marlin.
Easy for you to say.
Yeah, I know.
That'd be for third place. Remember Marlin just taking two tires on his lap 57 pit stop while Gordon got four. Gordon mowed through most of the traffic. In fact, the other guys that got two tires have both slipped back. So an interesting dilemma for the crew chiefs. You got Marlin who's held his ground on the two tires, but the other guys have fallen back.
But Sterling's not really holding his ground. Yes, I mean, because Rusty and Dale Jr. are pulling away from him, and Jeff Gordon right behind him is clearly faster than the 40 car right now.
And Sterling knows if he gets up on that top line, he's going to get railroaded. There's a bunch of guys in line that are going to go right by. So he's got to protect that bottom as much and as long as he can.
But I think, Alan, your point is correct. He was the best of the cars that changed two tires, Sterling Marlin.
He's hanging in there.
Until Jeff runs out of patience.
You think Jeff will run out of patience?
Really?
I've never wanted a driver to do that.
Guarantee it.
Not here at Bristol, anyway. Sterling Marlin in desperate need of a good finish. Desperate being the fact that his last 16 races 16 races. He's only got two top 10 finishes.
Wait a minute. What happened here?
A pass.
A pass for the lead. Rusty Wallace, two car, goes by Junior in front.
Second time tonight, Rusty has led.
Evidently, he was making the 8 car, Dale Jr., run just a little bit harder than he wanted to go. He talked to his crew about the back end just jumping out every once in a while, and he certainly does not want that to happen. So he's going to back up a little bit and ride.
Right on board here with Jr. See how hard these guys work on a racetrack like this. You never, ever rest. This place is the toughest race to race. I mean, it is very physical. You're sliding the car. The car's drifting all over the place. It's busy.
Listen, a little burst of RPM out of the engine.
Well, what happens is when you get on the throttle, sometimes those high, it'll break loose, and you got to back off on the throttle and wait till it gets traction, then get right back on the gas. So you're dancing inside that car every single lap. And he's got clean racetrack right there. He's not really being pressured. But even on the straightaway, you see you never keep steering wheel straight very long.
So Junior continuing to pursue Rusty Wallace, try and hang with him, and stay in contact with the new leader. Bill?
Talked to Rusty just before the drivers' meeting this evening, Alan. He's very confident. He also expressed that on the Discover Car countdown to green. One reason for that is when they got here on Friday, they put the car on the track. They went all the way they could one way, then brought it back to their starting point, went all the way the other way, brought it back to their starting point. Felt they were very good. They built some adjustability into it, but felt they were pretty much where Rusty wanted to be, but he's never satisfied, and Rusty knew that.
So, Bill, when you're talking about bringing the car in one direction or the other, they went to the freer, the looser side, and then back to the tighter side. So
exactly.
They knew what to do with the car.
You have a game plan. You want to go one way with it. Then you want to bring it back and go the other way. Make sure you're exactly where you felt you were. Now, you're not too loose. You're not too tight. You're as good as you can possibly make Rusty at Bristol. That's not easy to do.
And I think another thing, Bill, a lot of these guys are doing or they're experimenting with, they're getting these cars so soft. They're trying to see how soft they can get these cars and how much damage they'll do once they bounce off the racetrack and then back up from there.
Soft in terms of the spring rates, the springs they have up under the car.
Right, if you watch the cars in the corners, and if I watch Rusty like in turn three, that car really, really crushes down to the racetrack, and that's giving the cars grip. But you gotta be careful you don't wear off the oil pan and, you know, things like that underneath the race car.
And I tell you what, I talked about Sterling Marlin holding up Jeff Gordon. That's not the case anymore. He is driven away from Jeff Gordon. So that two-time stop for Sterling Marlin, I am impressed with it. And Gordon evidently having some problems right now with that 24 car.
Jeff in fourth place, trying to hold off McMurray for fifth.
Benny, you're all over it on the 24. He just said on the radio, we're tight, man. We're getting into real trouble here. Gordon on the radio.
All right, Bill, thanks. Mark Martin kind of lurking behind these two, looking to close in. Comings and goings, Jimmy Spencer, Casey Mears back on the racetrack after damage to their cars repaired behind the wall. Rusty Wallace, the leader here at Bristol.
The Sharpie 500 on TNT is brought to you by Sharpie, right out loud. By Budweiser, it's time for a fresh one. Grab a Budweiser, the race is on. By Discover Card, it pays to discover. And by new M3 Power from Gillette, the new power behind the Gillette Young Guns.
One quarter distance in Thunder Valley tonight before a sellout crowd of 160,000 and a new leader. In the Sharpie 500, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has just gone by Rusty Wallace to reclaim the top spot.
Yeah, I think Rusty saw Earnhardt coming. Rusty just pulls up the racetrack and lets Dale Jr. go. Watch right here. He'll go in the corner and say, you're pretty fast right now. Go ahead. I'll follow you for a while.
I'll tell you what, Rusty did not get off that corner very well, but now, once Jr. got by him, he's able to stay right behind him.
We've had some trouble trying to get this done because it seems like every time we do it, the caution flag comes out. We'll give it our best shot here. It's our Visa through the field. The race leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. What?
Almost trouble.
All right, let us do this here, Wally. There's no crash. Marty, go.
I started to think we're never going to get this thing done, are we? Dale Earnhardt Jr. leading, trying to fend off Rusty Wallace and trying to do something nobody's ever done at Bristol. When the Busch race and the Cup race car just a little bit tight, Rusty Wallace going for the lead, Bill.
Rusty back to the lead of Bristol, a familiar sight. A few laps to go. The car's getting a little loose. We'll be okay. That's a story on the two.
Sterling Marlin in the 40 car, tried the two-tire stop, basically happy with it, even though he's been passed now by Jamie McMurray. Bottom line is, if they had to use it later in the race for track position, they would.
So Marlin back and forth, and Jamie McMurray is now up to third. And that would be Marty, I believe.
I believe that is me, Alan. Lap 119, Jamie McMurray came on the radio saying, it's just a little bit loose, not too bad right now, guys. He's been very happy with the car this afternoon, talking about an air pressure adjustment. Bill.
The 24 of Jeff Gordon at the brand new car, never turned a lap till they got him here on Friday. It is starting to get tight on him, Matt.
Bill, the 6 of Mark Martin runs in 6. They know how strong Gordon is. They're trying to mirror their strategy after the 24. He's still free on exit, Marty.
Jimmy Johnson last pitted at lap 58 in the 48 car. Next stop, they want to take more tape off the grill. Again, they've had water temperatures, and the grill has been knocked in a good bit on the 48 car. Elias Sadler in the 38 car says the car is a little bit tight. He's worried about using up the right front tire. What's more, forward bite, Bill.
Ryan Newman in the 12 car pitted lap 57. Car was a little tight. They made some adjustments. No words from Ryan. That's a good sign, Matt.
Rounding out the top 10 is Casey Kane. His car, they fixed the loose in the back end of the race car with a track bar adjustment. The car, though, still up on top of the racetrack. He's trying to hold on with only two tires on that last stop.
Those are your top 10, 29 cars on the lead lap at this point. Dale Earnhardt Jr., one of three drivers who have led tonight. Jeff Gordon and Rusty Wallace are the others. Did I just say Earnhardt Jr. was leading? Rusty is leading.
Rusty's leading.
My bad.
Well, we see Scott Riggs, a 10 car, has gone a lap down now. Quite a few cars up in front of the leader, Rusty Wallace, that he has to contend with.
Boy, Rusty's record here at Bristol, when you look at the numbers, they're astounding. In his career here, he has won 22% of his starts, finished first or second 39% of the time, 51% of the time he finishes in the top five, and 68% of the time he finishes in the top 10.
And wasn't it Weber was talking about is not a top 10 finish since Charlotte, but not because he hasn't been there. He's been running really good these last few races, but had a lot of bad luck.
Yep.
Been up front a bunch of times.
And of course, Rusty has a press conference scheduled for Daytona Beach, Florida, and Daytona USA on Monday. Much speculation about what the announcement might be.
Oh, come on.
Much of it centered around the fact that will next season be Rusty's final year?
Very last season.
In Nextel Cup Racing. He keeps running like this, you might have to reconsider. I don't know.
It's tough when you're having fun.
Casey Kane, the 9 car, has started to struggle just a little bit. He was 10th when we went through the field.
Wow, Casey looks like he's got...
And now he's back to 12th. It's going to be 13th, 14th when he comes off this corner.
It looks like the car's acting like he's got a tire down or something, but he may have picked up some rubber or something.
He's going back to 15th position on that 9 car.
From Robbie Gordon. And just ahead of Kevin Harvick is Casey Kane.
Whatever the case, it doesn't look like this car is turning very well.
How about Kevin Harvick, Dave?
Yeah, success here pretty much last night in the Busch race and a lot here in the past. Hasn't had much to say good, though, tonight. In fact, in the last pit stop, he made a change, but he's lost grip in all the corners, he said. Not sure what change they're going to make on the next stop, Matt. The car of the 9, Casey Kane, still on the free side, talking to crew chief Tommy Baldwin about what adjustments to make. And Wally, for a driver, you don't want to get in somebody's way, so they move you up and you really lose position.
position. So how do you judge when to let people go by so you're going to be safe?
Yeah, well, I kind of talked about it earlier, Matt. You try to let guys by if you know you can get back down, but it seems like he has his hands really, really full. If the car is loose getting in, he may be able to adjust the brakes, put more front brake in it, and that may help the car. But if the car is loose on the gas, he's going to have to ride it out. And if you're really struggling like he is, you got to let everybody by. Because if somebody even gets close to touching your rear bumper, you're going to go around when you're that loose.
So Casey came back to 18th place while Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt Jr. continue to pace the field. 150 laps complete. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Beautiful night in Bristol, Tennessee, where the Sharpie 500 is underway at the Bristol Motor Speedway. 160 of the 500 laps complete. Rusty Wallace leads Dale Earnhardt Jr. by about an even second. Our Singular Wireless Race Talk poll, we've talked about the bump and run here at Bristol. Fairly commonly used tactic this day. How do you feel about it? Is it anything goes? It's okay as long as you don't wreck the guy, or if it's dirty racing?
Wow. I think anything goes, and it's dirty racing, so it's okay.
Explain that again. Come on, help me with your logic here.
I have no logic.
Okay.
Can't help you.
I'm just shocked that folks say it's okay as long as you don't wreck that guy. The bump and run, but we've already seen that tonight.
How about a five-time Bristol winner, Jeff Gordon? What does he think of the bump and run and its acceptability as a tactic?
I think the bump and run is acceptable, you know, if you're going for the win and at what level you take it to. I mean, I think if you just go in there and put the guy on the wall, you know, I think that's extreme. I think that, you know, if you can get to his bumper and you can move him and it's for the win, then I think it's acceptable.
There you have it.
And guess what? He didn't even have to be bumped out of the way. He just was passed by Mark Martin. Was Martin in the fifth position?
So Jeff slipping back to sixth, Bill.
That's because the car is wicked tight in the center. That's a direct quote.
Wicked tight's pretty bad.
That's a lot to say going around here under the green flag, so.
That's a two-word.
Wicked tight. Wicked tight. How about Mark Martin, man?
His car tight, but not wicked tight. You can see him slowly gaining on the 24, that he finally took over that position. Just trying to settle in and ride. They know they're breaking this race down into two sections. 400 laps of survival, and 100 of game on. Let's go for the win.
That's a good way to do it. Real good way to do it.
Let's ride with Mark.
Takes his hand, look like he take hand right off the wheel, slides it over. Yep,
he does.
I love watching the eyes through the clear visors at night. You can't see him during the shaded ones during the day. Watch his eyes dance up to the mirror on the straightaway. And
yeah, you always check your mirror usually right when you're getting off the corner. Here the car broke loose there when he got on the gas. Go through the corner, look in the mirror,
looking left around the corner ahead of the car.
Quick look. Do that a lot of times.
So that's Mark running in fifth place now after starting in seventh. Heavy traffic for the race leaders.
And that includes in the front of this group the 9 car of Casey Kane, trying desperately to hang on to that 10th spot in the NASCAR Nextel Cup points, but is struggling, and here comes the leaders.
Terry Labonte put a lap down. Ricky Craven, Jeff Green, Scott Riggs, Kenny Wallace. Next up, it's Ward Burton in the zero for Rusty Wallace. By the way, Ken Schrader back on track from behind the wall, his car having been repaired.
Oh, Ward Burton loose off turn 4. And Rusty saw that and said, okay, I'm going to get my nose right underneath your car. He's going to drive down here. Watch Ward Burton off the corner here.
But Burton is really struggling with that straight ahead bite, isn't he? Rusty just closed up right on the back bumper.
Here's where that patience thing comes into play if you're Rusty Wallace, too.
Here he comes. there.
That car five in front of Rusty Wallace is Casey Kane.
Ward knows he's got to get the power down. He's got to drive straight off these corners best as he can now because Rusty Wallace is about to put him back down.
And talking about Rusty and patience, do you want to try the outside? Do you move Ward out of the way? You just nipped him there with a bumper, I think.
You can't do that when you've got Earnhardt or anybody else on your tail. So you got to hope that Ward slides up the racetrack.
And this has allowed the 42 car, Jamie McMurray, to come into the play. He's right behind Junior.
So now you got to use your bumper. Now Rusty's going to get impatient, and Rusty's going to have to move these guys, or he's going to be in trouble.
Talking about McMurray creeping into the picture, Marty.
Alan, that was a big wiggle for Rusty Wallace. Jamie McMurray, one of the fastest cars on the track. I believe he called him the fastest cat in the alley right now.
Yeah.
This car's going really well. Came on the radio lap 160, said it's just a little bit loose. The air pressure adjustment you made last time made it almost perfect. If it goes green, and it might, they have to pit about lap 225. Bill?
And Marty, some guys are going to have to come earlier than that. Guys talk about coming as early as 187. That's less than 10 laps from now.
Yeah, remember Rusty Wallace pitted at lap 21. Earnhardt Jr. at lap 37.
And now Casey Kane is just two cars in front of the leader, Rusty Wallace. And it's hard to pick up positions from a lap down. You just got to somehow, some way, stay in the lead lap.
I can't believe Rusty's been this patient.
With the zero car,
yeah, especially with the guys in his mirror.
Rusty working him. This would be for eighth place. Ryan Newman trying to work his way back toward the front. And Jeff Burton going to follow him.
I tell you, this 30 car, and we see finally Rusty Wallace gets by the zero. The next car in front of Rusty, Casey Kane.
There he is.
Matt, what are they saying in the nine? Yes, they got to be a little bit concerned.
BP, Tommy Baldwin just told Casey, that's the leader in your mirror. Casey's trying to hold on, trying not to lose a lap, but this race car is just getting worse and worse. Remember, he didn't get an opportunity to run that final practice session. They did not in the first session try two tires and see what it would do. Right now, just holding on, hoping for a caution.
Casey Kane 10th in the championship standings. We check the race to the chase with three races to go, including this one.
Well, there's the top five. We're not concerned about that. We're concerned about Jeremy Mayfield.
Look at Mark Barton.
Wow.
In
ninth spot. And Kane out currently.
Check that out.
Labonte out. Bobby Labonte was knocked out. As it runs.
Bobby running back in 19th place right now in the race.
And Jarrett back in 15th, only 49 points out of 10th if the race would end. And now Casey Kane does go a lap down to Rusty Wallace.
There's not a whole lot Casey could do right now. I mean, he's just hanging on.
And he can't stay in front of Ward Burton in the zero either. If he could, he'd be the first car. Well, he held him off for now.
Right now, he's the lucky dog.
That is the race to be, the first car not on the lead lap right there, 9 and 0. If the caution were to come out, not an unreasonable expectation here in Bristol. Listen to Rusty Wallace's tires spin.
It's good to have horsepower, but you got to be able to put it down.
And Ward Burton did get by the nine car, so that took the lucky dog out of the equation.
Change for fourth. Mark Martin by Sterling Marlin. So one of the hottest drivers on tour of late, Mark Martin, with three top three finishes in the last four races, creeping toward the front. Battle of the Brewers going on at the front of the pack tonight here in Bristol as the Bud Wagon tries to go around the Miller Wagon and does so. So new leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. We were trying to go to a break before that happened. Three different drivers trading the lead throughout the first 200 laps of the Sharpie 500 here at Bristol Motor Speedway. Jeff Gordon, Rusty Wallace, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. down in front now, opening up a second and 6/10 on Wallace after passing him a couple of laps ago. Here's the gap back to Rusty.
Quite a considerable gap. This is by far the largest lead we've seen all night. And Junior is running up on some heavy, heavy lap traffic. Todd Bodine, the 50 car. The next car, Todd Bodine currently running 22nd.
Yeah, there's about 9 or 10 cars there, all in a row.
Now, we're going to start to see some green flag pit stops here momentarily. And remember that under the green flag, as a matter of fact, Jeremy Mayfield ducks in there, you see.
Get your gas ready, guys. Get your gas ready to put something in this carburetor now. Where's your gas thing at, Claude?
Out of gas. Out of fuel.
Looks like he ran. The 19 car of Jeremy Mayfield hits pit road. One of the guys in the chase for the championship. Making a four-tire stop, adding fuel. Now, just a few spots behind him on pit road. Rusty Wallace looks like he might have run out of fuel coming out of four. Coast it around. It's four tires. It's going to be no changes. The question is, can he get him fired? He's got it running now. He's got it running hard. You hear those? They're going to have to push him to get him going. This is really going to be possible. This is hard work. It's a hot, humid night here in Bristol. Rusty trying to get it refired. Ran it out of gas. It should have been in by lap 200. They didn't come in, and this is going to be brutal.
Running out of fuel. Didn't that happen to Ryan here last year or something?
Ryan Newman?
Didn't they run out of gas too? They were trying to push the car and push the car. I don't remember where it was, but
You
run out of fuel and you can't get that car refired, especially here at Bristol. Everything happens so fast, you lose a bunch of time.
But Rusty finally got it refired, but now he's three laps behind the leader. The 8 car of Dale Earnhardt Jr., 3 laps behind. I heard him saying about running out of fuel. I thought it was Jeremy, but instead it was the leader, guy running in second spot, Rusty Wallace.
This is a race now for 6th and 7th. Jimmy Johnson, 48. Ryan Newman, 12. Johnson coming from the back of the pack in his backup car. Remember, they played the pitch strategy track position thing to get himself up front.
And this is where you got to be careful, because now you got guys on fresh tires. Now you have guys sliding all over the place. And this is where sometimes you'll get a caution, because there's a lot faster cars.
Marty, how about more on Jimmy Johnson?
This car has really come to life, Alan, here late in the run. The car has been excellent. All they're doing is reading on lap time. They're planning no changes on the next stop. They have to pit at about 3 to 4 laps.
So that's the story there for Jimmy Johnson. Rusty Wallace back in 27th place. Jeremy Mayfield, 26th. Jimmy Johnson stopping at lap 37 is when he was in.
You see that? We talk about strategy and what these teams are doing, but it's such an elusive target.
Yeah.
It just keeps shifting around on you.
And remember, Casey Kane on the fresher tires, like you were talking about, Wallace, just blasted by Ryan Newman.
Yeah, and this is good for him, because he's making up a lot of ground right now. Hopefully the yellow doesn't come out for him.
Right.
These guys are really, really sliding around on those older tires.
That's how it's good for him. Making up time as long as the race stays green through a full set of pit stops for everybody in the field.
Yes. Then it won't be so bad.
Caution comes out.
You're done.
Deep.
Big trouble.
Jeff Gordon still chasing Sterling Marlin. Now that is for 4th and 5th place as Mark Martin has gone through. And here comes Superman on the fresh tires.
Yeah, and you're going to be about you're going to be a second to 2 seconds faster a lap on new tires right there than these guys who are running in 4th and 5th position.
Jeff Gordon under Marlin.
Junior on the pit road.
Marty, remembering the mistakes Jeff Gordon has made here the last 2 years, they reminded him twice. Pit off of turn four, off of turn four. The car just a little bit tight for Junior. Half round the web into the right side, trying to loosen up. Four tires so far. Quick stop for the 8 bunch. Nice stop.
And gone.
30 miles per hour down pit road.
And again, as Marty was saying, because it's a green flag pit stop, now you go right back onto the racetrack from there.
See a lot of sparks coming out of the Jimmy Spencer's car right here. I don't know if the exhaust pipe has fallen off or falling off or what, but I think NASCAR is going to give him the black flag, because if that comes off, you don't want to hit that.
Yeah, see it dragging there, bouncing up and down. That's tough. What a lousy night for Jimmy at his favorite racetrack.
He loves this place. He runs good here.
Jimmy Johnson on pit road. Greg Biggle just leaving the pit lane. Marty?
Second place man of the championship. Very happy with his race car. The grill is dinged in just a little bit. They wanted to pull a piece of tape off. Now they've decided not to do that. Chad Canals very happy with the car. Jimmy says leave it alone. No changes. They clean the grill. He's away.
14-8. And Matt Kenseth's in, Dave.
Overall tight, but he needs grip all the way around. Air pressure adjustment for Matt. Send it back out. A four-tire stop here, hoping for 13 or 14 seconds so he doesn't lose too much time.
Robbie Gordon coming down the pit lane on the back stretch as Kenseth leaves. And the defending series champion will rejoin the race.
Go ahead, Matt.
They're making a chassis adjustment on the 31 on his first stop. They've been an air pressure adjustment. Robbie Gordon's been fighting tight all night as the 6 car is also preparing to come in as the 31 standing away, Marty.
Elliott Sadler with a top 10 run. That the car, though, very, very loose for Elliott. 2 rounds down on the track bar. They also make an air pressure adjustment on 3 of the 4 tires for the 38 team. Still having a nice run, though.
So Sadler leaves. Jamie McMurray is the leader now. Mark Martin does peel off the banking and hit the pit road on the backside. And McMurray comes in on the front side. Go ahead, Matt.
Pat Rison counts Mark Martin into his pit stall. The car tight on this last run. They were going to make an air pressure adjustment to the 6, chasing his 8th career. Next out comes short track win. Having a good run tonight, Marty.
Jamie McMurray, Matt, with a very fast car. So it's just a little loose in, a little tight off. Very slight air pressure adjustment. 14-7 on the stop for the 42 gang.
Mark may have had a little trouble on that stop.
But he's coming around pit road. Mark, go on the racetrack. Mark, get on the racetrack.
Oh,
it's green flag, Mark. Oh, no.
Mark, oh, no.
He just came down pit road.
He just, that is a terrible mistake right there.
You see, he's supposed to be on the racetrack running wide open, yet he's 30 miles per hour. He's going to be a lap down when this is all over.
You only have to do that if it's yellow.
Yes.
All right, Sterling Marlin was in. Now Jeff Gordon comes down pit road at lap 228. Your turn, Bill.
And they made it very clear to Jeff Gordon into the pit off of turn 4. Gordon is in pit stall 1. He's over the line. He has to back up. He does. That will cost him seconds. Ryan Newman is headed directly behind him.
Yeah, I guess.
And even stacks up in the pits.
And Tony Stewart beats them both out in the 20 car.
So Michael Waltrip is now the leader as green flag pit stops continue. Bobby Labonte, Todd Bodine, Brian Vickers, Ward Burton yet to stop. How about the 20 stop, Marty?
And one of the reasons he was able to beat those guys out is because he had a clean in and a clean out for them. 11th running is where they were running when they came down pit road. The car too tight for Tony. Up on the truck bar, wedge in.
Going to lose a spot to Jeff Gordon there.
You see Jeff Burton coming back in the action after making a pit stop.
Ward Burton out of the pit lane. Had moved up as high as 5th. Now we watch Michael Waltrip, who is the race leader. Michael, remember, started in the back, in a backup car after his qualifying crash. Had moved steadily up into the top 20, stayed on the lead lap. He was up to 17th before this cycle of pit stops began. Mark Martin losing a lot of time. Let's get an update there, Matt.
Alan Marks, crew chief Pat Tryson in complete shock. Couldn't believe what he was seeing. In fact, he didn't even know Mark was going down pit road on the front stretch until he saw it on the Jumbotron separating both pits. We've seen a lot of guys for the past year or two who've done this. Bill Elliott, Bill talked about Jeff Gordon. Gordon even has a map on his dash to explain to him green versus yellow stops. What a heartbreaker for Mark Martin. They've got some work to do here, guys.
Yeah, it's very confusing when you have to do. Normally you just come down pit lane and it's the same thing. But here's the only place where it's different, green to yellow.
And I understand both sides. I understand the necessity for the procedure to take away the disadvantage of pitting on the back as Michael Waltrip comes in.
Oh.
But I,
contact. Mark Martin made contact with a 50 car as he went by. He's about like Michigan last week.
Yeah.
He's possessed again.
Go ahead, Dave.
They stayed out as long as they could. Couldn't catch the caution. They'll make an air pressure adjustment. They've been doing that all night. The car has felt like it's skating on top of the track for Michael. Finally feels like it's come in a little bit. Four tires and he's gone.
So Bobby Labonte now the leader, followed by Todd Bodine, Brian Vickers, Ricky Craven, and then it'll cycle back around to Dale Earnhardt Jr. Here's Bobby coming in, and that's in front of Mr. Weber.
And they reminded Bobby Labonte, please come in off turn four, watch your RPMs, into the stall, nobody in front of him or behind him needs more forward bite. Looks like they're going to try to do that with an air pressure adjustment and pack that little fuel, not want to run out of Bristol. Out of the left side, side tires off to Labonte, trying to stay in that chase to the championship.
So Bobby goes out, Todd Bodine is now the leader. And the first of the cars who have pitted, that position has just changed hands as Labonte rejoins the race. That's Todd Bodine, the leader. Brian Vickers is second. Now Jeff Gordon has come up and passed Dale Earnhardt Jr. But that is not, it's not for position. That was just to get Gordon back on the lead lap, basically.
But Gordon is making up a lot of time with those tires, as you can see.
All right, Marty.
What a run for Todd Bodine and Don.
And Craven is in, and so it'll be Dale Earnhardt Jr. back into the lead here at Bristol. Just to button up the point we were making before the rest of the pit stops happened. I understand the necessity of the procedure for having separate pit roads under green and under caution here. The teams just have to talk their drivers through it.
Well, that's right. Jeff Gordon did the same thing two races in a row in the 24 car.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, Wally. You're right. It's not normal. It's not what the driver's used to doing. So the spotter, the crew chief, they've got to make sure they walk their man through it.
Yep.
When that spotter looked up and saw him on the apron of 3 and 4, realized what he was doing, he should have said, get on the racetrack, get on the racetrack.
You're absolutely right, Benny.
So Earnhardt Jr. is the leader. The pit stop cycle complete without the caution flag interrupting. We'll reset the running order for you when NASCAR on TNT returns to Thunder Valley. Opened in July 1961, the first race attended by 18,000. Tonight, the Sharpie 500 running before a sold-out crowd of 160,000 here at Bristol Motor Speedway. They are watching Dale Earnhardt Jr. lead the race by 6.4 seconds over Jimmy Johnson. We check the Gillette Young Guns. First micro-power shaving system from Gillette, the new M3 Power, the new power behind the Gillette Young Guns. The Young Guns have led the championship after 22 of 23 races this season. They're leading the race right now.
They aren't doing too badly. First, second, and fifth.
So that's Jeff Gordon on the tail end of the lead lap just in front of Earnhardt Jr. Gordon in 11th place.
And when do we think Earnhardt's going to stop?
Let me do the numbers while we talk about Mark Martin here for a second. He had a close call in traffic.
Yeah, running behind the 9 car of Casey Kane. Never see Mark. And he's out there with fresh tires, and Kane has used up his tires. And there's that real estate that I was talking about. The 9 car said, I'm not going to give you that. He came down and almost got knocked in the fence. A good job by Casey Kane not to hit the outside retaining wall.
So Mark running along right now in 20th place. A lap down after the mistake on the pit procedure under the green flag. Remember we saw the championship standings earlier and Mark was in?
He's out now.
The chase? Well, let's have a look.
Let's have a look.
All right, forget about it. We're not interested in 1 through 5.
Yes, we are. We want to see who's leading the championship.
Okay.
Well, Mark Seamus and then
we don't see Mark Martin, but Dale Jarrett is now 10th.
Wow, up 4 spots.
And Mayfield is 9th. Kane is out.
15th.
Mark goes back to 15th.
Wow.
Man, oh man.
So close, so volatile. And we're at Bristol. Earnhardt Jr. putting pressure on Jeff Gordon, the man who's been, along with Rusty Wallace, his toughest competition tonight. He's trying to put him a lap down as we're just past halfway. at Bristol Motor Speedway, NASCAR on TNT with the Sharpie 500 just past its midway point. Lap 271 of 500 is complete. Dale Earnhardt Jr., the race leader. NASCAR fans, you can log on to NASCAR.com and ask Benny and Wally questions about next week's NASCAR Nextel Cup race, your favorite driver, or the latest NASCAR news.
Boy, aren't those two good-looking guys there?
Let's not get carried away. Look for the Benny and Wally picture on the NASCAR.com homepage on Sundays. Click on the link, ask your questions, check out the responses, log on today.
Casey Kane.
Questions I'm going to file there.
Yeah.
We saw Casey Kane just beat lapped by the leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. He's now two laps down in 23rd position.
We have eight cars on the lead lap at this point. The long green flag run that we're in has spread the field, the different pit strategies we're on, and so forth. And Dale Earnhardt Jr., it's all working his way so far, and we're not looking all that great in the opening laps of the race.
And all of his, looks like his toughest competitors tonight, Rusty Wallace, Jeff Gordon, Mark Martin, all those guys have had trouble in the pits. Marty?
I was going to talk about the leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr., VP, and I spent some time with him before the race. We watched Robbie Gordon trying to come up through the field. Junior told me his car was actually not that good in happy hour. What they did, they took a lot of the setup off the Busch Series car that won here yesterday in the race last night. Junior said, I hope it works on this car. It should translate. I'll let you know after the first stop. And I would have judged after the first stop that his car is pretty good, and that was a good decision to take some of that setup and put it on the Budweiser Chevrolet.
Yes, sir.
I'll agree with that.
You see Junior opening the gap on second place Jimmy Johnson over this last series of laps. VP and I saw Junior just after the driver's meeting today as we were getting set to come up here to the booth. I talked to him about his burns. I said, how are you feeling, knowing that this is a pretty physically demanding race and a little tough in the race car? He said, I'm getting better. Every day, I feel a little bit better. He said, they're still gross, and they're still there, but yeah. I'm getting better, and I feel good.
That 24 is getting better, too. I think the pressures are finally coming up in those tires because it looks like he's closing the gap on Junior right now.
Race for seventh. Elliott Sadler, 38. Greg Biffle, 16. Here are the last two cars on the lead lap. Right there.
And they aren't, but about 2.5, 2-3 seconds in front of the leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. As a matter of fact, he is in the same straightaway with them. So the one on the right would be the one to press now, try to get away.
So a long green flag run here at Bristol. We went back to the green at lap 98. We're almost 200 laps later. And the caution hasn't waved. That's somewhat of an unusual occurrence here. Through the field, when we come back to Thunder Valley, Dale Earnhardt Jr. leading the Sharpie 500. Contenders have been taken out of contention by mistakes on pit road.
Here's Mark Martin. He should have been up on the racetrack and not where he's at, but we'll explain that in a second.
And also, 30 miles per hour instead of 100 miles per hour, 30 miles per hour. Rusty Wallace, running well, runs out of gasoline. Had to push the car to get it restarted.
Lots of track position loss right here.
And then Jeff Gordon.
Went too far, he got to push it back. That cost him and the car behind him of Ryan Newman because Ryan couldn't get out.
So drivers who were contending for up front spots now back in the pack.
Now here's what happened. Mark Martin is supposed to enter the pits here. Stop, make his pit stop, go on a race, and come back on the racetrack. Instead, now that's the green flag scenario. That's what you're supposed to do on the green. On the caution, you come in here, and you go all the way around, as Mark Martin did, at 30 miles per hour, and exit here at 30 miles per hour. All this distance, 30, instead of up on the racetrack, running wide open.
So, okay? That is a ton of track position lost.
And so it has left Mark in 20th place, one lap down to leader Dale Earnhardt Jr. Rusty Wallace just in front of him in 19th, also a lap down. Jeff Gordon is also a lap down in 9th place. Let's go through the field, update you on the front runners. Marty, you're first.
Three-time winner this year, Dale Earnhardt Jr. cruising right now, going for win number 4 of 2004. He said zilch on the radio since the last stop. They will stop at lap 365. They can make it on one more stop. Jimmy currently tracking him down. Currently also not saying anything on the radio. He's had three straight DNFs so far. So good for Jimmy Johnson as he started 11th, currently in second. Jamie McMurray, his car, on lap 282. He said, you need to help me into the corners. A little too loose into the corner for the man 15th at the championship. Dave?
Marty, Dale Jarrett was 10th before the green flag pit stops. They picked up six positions in the transition with a sub-15-second pit stop. Also for Matt Kenseth, another great pickup, 10 spots in the transition. They were under 14 seconds on their pit stop, and it's going really well for them. For the 40 car, those left side tires, 226 laps on them. They looked pretty good when they came off the car, and the air pressure adjustment they made put more grip in this car. It's now neutral for Sterling. Marty, back to you.
Dave Elliott Sadler came on the radio about 15 laps ago, said the car is still a little bit tight. Started 8th tonight, currently in 7th position. One of the fastest cars on the track right now, Matt.
Greg Biffle working on his first career short track win at Nextel Cup, but his biggest concern lies in his mirror. Directly off his deck lid, it's driver eight. Greg Biffle says the car has been tight. They worked on it with air pressure most of the night, but it just still gets tighter, guys.
And those are all of your lead lap cars.
That through the field didn't last long, did it?
Well, we can keep going. Some of the guys that are trying to get a lap back, how's that? How about we go with ninth place Jeff Gordon, Bill?
Yeah, I had a bunch of guys on the lead lap. Now I got nobody on the lead lap down here, including this guy, Jeff Gordon. The car's just way too tight. We're hurting it getting in. We're just not helping. As for the 12 of Brian Newman, Roger Penske on the radio, spotting for him, encouraging him, but the car is just still too tight, Matt.
Robbie Gordon having a very solid run in the 11th position. His teammate Jeff Burton back in 12th. Now Robbie's car sliding the nose, just no rear grip. They made an air pressure adjustment and wedge to try to fix that. Meanwhile, the 30, Jeff Burton is having a very solid run as well. No adjustment. He says, I don't know what we can do to make this race car better. Last week at Michigan, he finished 12th. The best run for that 30 car all year.
Matt, the winner of the last three races here at Bristol is going to have to get back on the lead lap. He's going to win tonight, currently in the 13th position for Kurt Busch. He says, when I match the gas, front end just will not stick like it used to. I don't have the same feel in this car that I've had before. Tony Stewart has been tied all night long. They've tried several things trying to loosen that 20 car up. So far, not working. He's got six top tens in the last seven races, Bill.
Jeremy Mayfield in the 19 came out in the top 10 after his last pit stop. Then he's gone backwards faster than Wally with the check comp. The car is just tight and continues to push up in the center.
Allen.
Very nice.
Faster than what?
The faster than you when the check comes.
At the restaurant.
Very good, Weber.
This has been an exceptionally clean Sharpie 500, though it didn't start out that way. Five cautions in the first 100 laps, none in the 200 laps since. By the way, the last Sharpie 500 with fewer than eight caution flags, 1986. Junior leads at Bristol. How to get on TV at a night race.
It's a good way.
Those folks did that last year, too. We appreciate them thinking of us.
About that.
Looks like they ran out of some lights for that T, though, on the end. See if we can run some down.
Okay.
And I tell you what, that's motorhome. And there's a lot of camping around this racetrack. I read in the newspaper this morning, 8,500 motel rooms in this area. And we got 160,000 people here. A lot of camping going on.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., the race leader in the Sharpie 500 at 321 laps. He's out in front of Jimmy Johnson by 11 seconds on a track where they're lapping in 16.8 seconds. Kevin Harvick falling back, and falling back big, Dave.
When there's long green flag laps on this track, Alan, it can wear you out physically. Kevin Harvick's arms are asleep. He's looking for a backup driver. So anybody that, he almost has a wreck in front of him to get the caution, but he's looking for a backup driver right now because he cannot operate his vehicle correctly.
Well, here's the deal. You run these long greens and you can't get in, you can't get a drink of water, you can't put the ice pack. And I'll tell you what, you get dehydrated here. Like I talked about earlier, this is the most physical racetrack you run. And I have had Charlie horses during this race, and boy, is that fun.
These drivers, every one of them right now, running 200 laps of green flag on this racetrack. They're every one of them struggling. and some energy.
I don't know what the temperature is outside right now. It's hard to tell from up in here. Weber, you might be able to help us out with this, but it's a pretty warm and humid night here, too.
Yeah, it's very muggy. There's just a slight hint of a breeze, but that's, you know, they've really built this place into a huge bowl, Alan. It's very still in here, you know. I think they used to call it close, but it's humid, and it's uncomfortable. I can't imagine what it's like in the car.
You know, all these drivers really hydrate themselves. They actually start 2 or 3 days before the race.
Caution is out.
Debris 1 and 2.
There you hear.
Okay, so
debris turn one, the yellow flag at lap 327, sixth caution of the race. Last time they went back green was at 98.
So who could he get? Nemechek? Kevin LePage to drive the 29 car?
Well, maybe now that he gets the caution and he gets some fluid in him, maybe his arms will... The feeling will come back.
Yeah, because cautions at this racetrack will breed cautions.
Now, 173 to go. That is going to be on the bubble as far as tires and fuel are concerned. Well, not with fuel, but with tires. This could get interesting where strategy is concerned.
Someone told us today at 325 they're going to stop for the last time. They're going to stop. Now, I don't know if it's going to be for the last time or not.
Just before the caution came out, Elliott Sadler was passed by leader Dale Earnhardt Jr. That's the seventh place runner, so he, instead of Jeff Gordon, is going to get the lucky dog here, and Gordon's going to be still hung a lap down. Ouch.
And send us here, and we'll be ready. We got his stuff here. We just ain't got him yet. I guess he's getting his clothes on.
Pit road is going to be closed here for a second. They have some barriers, water-filled barriers, protecting where the pit crews are on the ends of the pit road here at Bristol. One of them's leaking. They're going to fix it before they let the cars come down pit road and the crews go to work. So we'll take a break here and come back for the pit stops in just a minute. Back at Bristol, under caution, and the pit road has just been opened for the six cars that are on the lead lap. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Jimmy Johnson, Jamie McMurray, Dale Jarrett, Matt Kenseth, and Sterling Marlin, Dave.
Great news for Dale Jarrett. No changes needed to his car. Temperatures are just fine. DJ very happy with the way the car is running now. They'll change four tires and send him slowly down around this pit road. Matt?
Earnhardt Jr. in on the front stretch side of pit road. Marty?
Dale Earnhardt Jr. says his car starts off loose, comes in real nice, a little too tight at the end of the run, half round of wedge, trying to loosen it up in the middle of the run. Jimmy Johnson behind him in second place, so they're doing awesome. Car at the start of the run, pushing a little bit off late in the run, air pressure adjustment trying to help him out. Jamie McMurray, little loose in, half pound into the right rear, trying to tighten up that race car.
And now the cars that are not on the lead lap beginning to work their way down the pit road, and that's about two-thirds of the field, Matt.
The 16 of Greg Biffle stops a little short in his box so his teammate Mark Martin can get around his car easily into his stall. Chassis adjustment with wedge and track bar to try to free this race car up. He was extremely tight. Now he's got trouble getting out. He is blocked in by his teammate Mark Martin. Now he's finally away. Nate.
Matt, Kevin Harvick moving slowly down pit road right now. They decided not to put Kyle Petty in the car yet. He is standing by. They gave Kevin some padding for his right, under his right arm to help prop his shoulder up to hopefully relieve that asleep situation in his, especially in his right arm. Weber?
Well, it's just been a battle for Jeff Gordon. A long pit stop after taking a spring rubber out of the left rear to try and help that car, which has just been way too tight for Gordon in the 24.
Now he's going to be behind about four or five other cars that are a lap down, Bill, so he won't be in great position to try and get that lap back on the restart. Earnhardt Jr. clearly holding the lead off the set of pit stops, and we're under caution with 168 to go here in Bristol.
The Sharpie 500 on TNT is brought to you by Sharpie, right out loud, by Wrangler, makers of Wrangler Jean Company, a new generation of Wrangler, and by Dodge. You can take life as it comes, or you can grab life by the horns. Dodge.
A long green flag run separating the field here at Bristol Motor Speedway, and we're getting ready to go back racing now with Dale Earnhardt Jr. out in front of the Sharpie 500. Kevin Harvick talking to his crew just a minute ago.
Well, let's get you some pads or something you put under your butt, jack you up a little bit. Somebody be hustling for a pad. Don't care who. Got to have some pads for the bottom of the seat, a couple inches worth.
Get him a little bit higher in the seat to try to get that seat pressure off from underneath his arm, right, Wally?
Right. The way the seat comes on these cars, it's right underneath your armpit and it's cutting off the circulation. Dave.
The other thing they asked him to do, Wally, how hard is this? Pull yourself over to the left when you're on the straightaway to take the pressure off of it under green conditions.
Impossible, Dave. You can't do that.
Impossibility is right.
Now, this is going to be an interesting restart because you got a lot of strong cars down on the bottom. So, but Earnhardt gets a great start.
Just seven cars on the lead lap. Dale Earnhardt Jr. trying to get around Kevin Harvick, who is that first car a lap down to the inside.
But he didn't clear him.
And actually, Harvick is two laps down. He's not even the first one, one lap down. That'd be Robbie Gordon. Right there. Scooted up the hill.
Yeah, and I'm telling you, these cars, the fresh tires, we talked about it earlier, these cars are so soft. You go into the corner, the car bottoms out, and you shoot up the racetrack. That's what happened to Robbie.
And so Robbie no longer the lucky dog, the guy in position for that. That'll be Jeff Burton now in the 30. And you see there, 42, Jamie McMurray. He's in fourth place trying to work his way through the traffic. That's actually a race for fourth and fifth in the traffic. McMurray 42 and Kenseth 17.
Oh, little bump on the 31 car. Marty, what about the 42 car?
This car has been very fast, BP. They made a very slight air pressure adjustment on the last stop, a little bit loose, trying to tighten up the 42 car. You talked about drivers getting tired here. It is hot here at Bristol tonight. Jamie is running a new seat. It's a carbon fiber seat that he's run all year long, but this tonight, it has holes in the back of it. That's a good point. Air going to his back. He just reported, I feel very comfortable and very good.
And the carbon fiber, Marty, it doesn't hold the heat like the aluminum seats do. So that's why it's a lot cooler for him.
Jeremy Mayfield slipping and sliding.
He had a moment up there in 3 and 4. I don't know if his car, no, it still looks like he might have a flat tire on the 19th. The guy that was.
That's him.
I don't know. He thinks he's got a flat tire. He's hitting pit road.
So Jeremy Mayfield, 11th in the race to the chase. He's got problems.
Right rear.
Yep. And with 156 laps to go, Bill. Big.
And I'll make that trip down pit road. Those right side tires. Creeping toward his pit stall. Slide it in there. Have to be careful. He doesn't go over the line. Just two right side tires here, but this costly for another guy trying to get into that.
One thing this does do for Jeremy Mayfield, he now can make it the rest of the way without stopping again. And some of the leaders might have to stop for fuel.
And he's got to hope this thing stays green the whole way, though.
Let's go back to that race for fourth. As Matt Kenseth continues to press, Jamie McMurray, 17 on 42.
Okay, now we're going to lose our patience. It's coming.
Oh,
McMurray
yeah.
is going to lay the bumper to Robbie here.
Well,
if he doesn't,
he may not get a shot to. Yeah, Matt. That's going to go underneath.
And Jeff Gordon in the mix with these cars. Jeff in 12th place, one lap down.
Now we'll see if the 17 uses his bumper. He'll be pretty smooth if he does it, Matt.
That's actually Dave, Wally, but we know that Matt Kenseth is smooth on the track, even if he tries to bump and run. He needed better grip on the car, so they made an air pressure adjustment on their last stop. Another great stop for them. Matt, to you now. Dave, the 31, right in front of the 17. Robbie Gordon kissed him on the radio set. It is 2-3 in the center of the corner. That's my problem. Meanwhile, his teammate, the 30, he is motoring away from the 88.
So the update's there. On Kenseth, now the fourth place driver, and some of the guys racing for that lucky dog spot right now to see if they can be the first one to lap down should the caution flag come out again.
And that's a moving target right now.
Yes, it is. Marty?
Yeah, Alan, just real quick on the 42 car, came on the radio a lap ago, said, guys, now it's too tight, fading back a little bit from the 17.
17 wants by badly. And I think the 17's faster than Robbie, but that real estate, they both want it, BP.
And there's going to be a big argument over that real estate in just a little bit.
Get closer to the finish.
What was that?
Like a piece of tarot or something.
By the way, Jeremy Mayfield after the unscheduled stop, 27th place. You know, watching all this, I talked about you can spot the place in traffic where the backup is. This is the backup now.
And I'm telling you what, Robbie's car is loose. Dave was right. I mean, this is...
How about this? For the lead.
Wow.
Jimmy Johnson out in front in his backup car. And Jeff Burton, first one lap down, is going to go by Dale Jr. Jr. slides in front of Dale Jarrett, hangs on to the second spot. How about that 48, Marty?
Yeah, what a recovery for this team in the backup car, driving the car that won at Darlington, finished second in California, of course, wrecked his primary yesterday. They've told Jimmy you're doing a great job, the car is excellent. They were going to make no changes on the last stop, decided at the last minute to make a wedge adjustment. Jimmy very happy with the car, and the caution is out.
That would be debris in turn four. And it would be yellow flag number 7.
That did not help Jeremy Mayfield.
Sure helped Jeff Burton. He's the lucky dog, and he has a very, very fast race car.
So that 30 car, second in line, is going to come around the pace car and come back around onto the lead lap and join the chase for a good finish.
And right now, only 7 cars on the lead lap, so.
Yep. So pit road is going to be open this time. We'll see if we get any takers when they go around turn two. I wouldn't expect many.
The ones that can't make it, couldn't make it the rest of the way at 325.
Well, Junior giving up second place.
Evidently something is wrong with this A car. He must want to make an adjustment.
Comes Kenseth.
Yeah.
McMurray.
Marlin. Elliott Sadler.
Guys that couldn't make it. And again, you brought up a very good point a while ago. Only 7 cars on the lead lap, so it's not a huge gamble right now. Marty?
Junior could have made it all the way, BP, on the fuel that he had, but he was not happy with that set of tires. He said the car was just way too loose, as loose as it had been all day long. They're going to come in, make an air pressure adjustment on the 8 car, give him 4 tires, hoping he can make it back through the field. He's led more laps at Bristol tonight than he's ever led in a Bristol race before. He's obviously got a fast car, but can he win with it?
So that's 5 of the 7, now 5 of 8 lead lap cars who come in as Jeff Burton goes around the pace car and joins the tail end of the field.
And when Junior, you know, they put those tires on and for some reason those tires didn't grip as well. And sometimes you get that in a set of tires. So I think that was a safe move.
And again, a lot of the other cars beat it. So he's going to come out about second or third on this deal. Jimmy Johnson and Dale Jarrett did not stop. Dave, Kevin Harvick coming down to attention of his pit.
And once again, Kyle Petty, whose 45 car is out of this race, wrecked earlier, has been called to replace Kevin in the cockpit. They're about the same size height, by Kyle maybe a little bit taller, and hopefully able to overcome that right shoulder situation that Kevin was having. Again, his right arm falling asleep. They know they have to get someone in there, so they'll pull Kevin out, and they'll put Kyle Petty in the 29 car.
And they're going to lose at least a couple of laps making this driver change, at least one, getting Kyle strapped in as the pace car is almost around to them now.
And this is going to, they're going to take a hit in points because of this.
So big turn there for some of the drivers in the race to the chase in the late stages here at Bristol tonight. Relief drivers used to be not an uncommon thing here at Bristol, right, BP?
Oh, no. I came here with John A. Esmond about every time I came in the 70s. I finally figured how to hold my head up, and it was okay after that. But
you actually won a race with a relief driver here, right?
Yeah. John A. and I won the race by 7 laps.
So Harvick getting attention for the numb left arm. Kyle Petty still strapping aboard that 29 machine.
It's tough to make driver changes in these cars today, though, because there's a lot more seat, there's a lot more safety equipment that we wear, and it's a lot harder. It takes a lot longer.
So under caution here at Thunder Valley, 7th one of the race, and the leader is Jimmy Johnson. We'll be back. Here at Bristol Motor Speedway, there'll be 137 laps to go in the Sharpie 500. 8 cars on the lead lap. Jimmy Johnson, Dale Jarrett, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Matt Kenseth, Jamie McMurray, the top 5,
followed by Sterling Marlin, Elliott Sadler, and Jeff Burton. Kyle Petty coming back out on track in Kevin Harvick's 29 in 29th place.
But he's still going to lose another lap because he pitted on the caution. He's got to come down pit road at 30. He came back on the racetrack, so maybe he doesn't have to.
That'll cost him. He'll have to come back.
I thought he had to run at 30 miles.
Newman, man, he dove it in there. He wants that lap back bad.
Yeah, Newman is the first car lapped out in the 12 in ninth place.
We got trouble.
Dale Jarrett.
Sterling Marlin goes around.
Tony Stewart goes around and gets clobbered.
Cautions, Bree, cautions.
Dale Jarrett running second. One of the drivers in that race to the chase, and he gets turned around with 135 laps to go.
He may be okay, though.
I don't think he got hit.
And the 31 gets into the back of the 88, perhaps?
Yep.
Looks like the 31 got on the apron of the race. I tell you what, look at... How in the world those guys go on the apron and control the thing?
I will say this for Robbie. I think he got on the apron trying to stay off.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, he got down there, but the problem is sometimes when you get down on that apron, like BP says, it shoots you back up the racetrack.
So caution flag is out here at Bristol. This is number 8. Second place runner Dale Jarrett gets spun around. A couple of others tangled up in behind him. Bristol, Tennessee, in the Bristol Motor Speedway, NASCAR on TNT with live coverage of the Sharpie 500 for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series. After a kind of timid center section of the race with more than 200 laps of consecutive green flag racing, we're sending the sparks flying and stacking up the yellow flags now. Dale Jarrett is falling back to 8th from 2nd after getting turned around over in turn number 2.
Yeah, the restart, Robbie... He was down on the apron, actually trying to avoid contact with the 88. He couldn't go any lower than he could, but
check it out.
He got down in the corner a little bit too strong.
And you see the different angle of it, and boy, Matt Kenseth just gets by 88 car.
Sterling Marlin punted by Carl Edwards. Tony Stewart clobbered by Jeff Green.
Boy.
Here's the shot that tells it all. Goes down further. I mean, just nowhere else to go.
Rusty Walsh, you're going to be able to see the 99 car go in there. Bam! In the back of the 40 car.
And so pit stops here. The pit road just having been opened. Dale Jarrett is in, along with Sterling Marlin and Tony Stewart. And the cars involved in this wreck getting repairs made. We'll get some further updates in just a minute. This race weekend has kind of become a happening for a lot of different reasons. One of them, weddings. 28 couples married this morning, starting at 10 a.m. on the start-finish line here at the world's fastest half mile. They're from all over the country. Certainly a unique matrimonial occasion. Back at Bristol, half a lap from the restart of the Sharpie 500. The NASCAR Nextel Cup Series on TNT with 127 laps to go in the green flag waves. Napa Field summary. 10 leaders tonight. The race dominated, though, by Dale Earnhardt Jr. He's led 195 of 372 laps. And the lead changes inflated some by a run of green flag pit stops we had mid-race.
Green flag, green flag.
97 got a good jump.
Kurt Busch trying to win 4 straight here at Bristol. That would put him tail end of the lead lap if he can stay in front of Jimmy Johnson.
Nice restart. I'm a little surprised at Robbie. He was kind of sleeping there a little bit on that restart.
Jimmy Johnson, the leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr. second, Matt Kenseth third, Jamie McMurray fourth, Elliott Sadler fifth, followed by Jeff Burton, Sterling Marlin, Dale Jarrett now in 8th, and Ryan Newman, the lucky dog on that last caution, lead lap, 9th place. For the lead, Jr. inside of Jimmy Johnson. That 48 car has been wiggling and wobbling since we went back to green.
Well, we can see that wiggle and wobble towards that 8 car because Jr. has some fresh tires on there, better than the 48 car. Marty, what about the 48? Has he complained?
No, he's not complaining. He said the car is a little bit free, but I'm a good free is what he said as Jamie McMurray made a nice save there. Chad
something else came over the radio under that caution. He said, you're doing an excellent job. I've never been more proud of you tonight than I have ever. Big compliment for Jimmy Johnson tonight, Matt.
And a 31 of Robbie Gordon runs in the 11th position. Under that caution, NASCAR notified the 31 team that if he hits any more cars tonight, he will go to the garage.
Oh, there they started to argue with that real estate, didn't they, Wally?
Yeah, he was winding down there, but Jeff Gordon was filling it.
Here's Robbie's problem.
he's got a big problem.
Well, he was trying to stay as being the first guy a lap down, and he's got these lead lap cars all surrounding him.
Yeah. If I'm Matt Kenseth, I'm going to lay the bumper to him really quick. And I know Robbie's trying to do everything he can to be in the lucky dog position, but Matt's got a good race car, and he's got to go.
Well, Robbie's no longer in the lucky dog position. When Jeff Gordon went by him, that was for that spot. So Gordon now the first one a lap down in 11th place. Robbie Gordon, Jeff that was. Robbie back in 12th. Matt Kenseth waving at him out the window saying, why you...
And you talk about looking out the window, seeing that jam up. Yep, once again, there it is.
That would be the pressure point.
He's going to get tagged if he can get to him.
And all this behind Robbie Gordon are racing for position on the lead lap. Kenseth, McMurray, Sadler, Jeff Burton. Robbie up out of the way. Matt?
This 30 team is having an awesome run tonight. Rocky Ryan, who is Jeff Burton's spotter, said the 17 of Kenseth and the 31 of Gordon are feeding on each other pretty good. Stay on your toes, be cautious in case something happens. Luckily, the 17 has motored by.
Now his teammates behind him.
Now this is one guy you really don't want to hold up because he's racing for the best position for Richard Childress Racing.
And Richard's going to get on the radio and tell him, Robbie, move out of the way. Let Jeff Burton go.
Laps to go, watching the pressure point on the field, if you will. The front cars in front of this group spread out somewhat. Earnhardt Jr., Johnson, the first car lap down, Jeff Gordon, Matt Kenseth, Jamie McMurray, Elliott Sadler. Those cars all kind of spaced out on the racetrack at the moment. Jeff Burton by his teammate. Brian Vickers, 25, not on the lead lap.
Now, Mark Martin, the 6 car, is up there. Oh,
there's a shot.
He gives a bumper to that 25 car and says, okay. Oh, in trouble.
Rusty Wallace, crunch.
Oh, man. Bobby Labonte.
Carl Edwards, Tony Stewart again.
Casey Kane. Who's that radiator, Steven? That's Carl's.
Carl Edwards.
Michael Waltrip got some damage in it. He's continued away, but he's driving around the racetrack smoking. And caution is out for the 9th time in the race.
It all started, I guess, when Mark and the 25 car got together. Rusty gets in the back of the 16. DJ gets in the back of Rusty and somehow gets by. Oh man.
Tony Stewart got a piece of that pretty big one.
Nowhere to go.
This would be the accordion effect.
See, the guys check up in front of you, so you check up, but it just stacks up behind you, and unfortunately, that's what happens. And fortunately, you get caught up in somebody else's mess.
Good gracious. How many times they hit him?
2 or 3.
Man.
Most everyone is driven away from the accident scene except Carl Edwards. We'll follow up on the damage when we come back. Pit Road is closed right now here at Bristol. Carl Edwards not enjoying his first Nextel Cup experience here at Bristol tonight. He's got that Bristol anger look going. Dave?
17 of Matt Kenseth a little bit tight. They make a wedge adjustment for that. 4 tires. They hated to take those off because that was a set they really felt good about. Marty?
Jimmy Johnson, your leader, coming in pit road. His car right now is a little bit looser. He says looser than it's been all evening. They had a pound to the right left rear tire, rather trying to tighten up that car. Said it wasn't like that before. Dale Earnhardt Jr., the stall in front of him. The car is good. No danger for him, Bill.
The 42 of Jamie McMurray, they talked about taking 2. McMurray said, let's put 4 on and let her eat. Let's see what happens.
Jeff Burton did not pit.
I think that's good strategy. I don't have any problem with that.
Oh, watch it.
You got to stop down there, boys.
Let the traffic clear. The stop paddle is up. Get back going here in a minute. So Jeff Burton's going to take over the lead of the Sharpie 500 with 109 laps to go. His team choosing to stay out on the track under this caution. Big Mass off of turn two has put the yellow flag out and got the cleanup crews kind of busy.
Riding around under caution, 394 laps complete on a hot, sultry night here in the Tennessee Hills at the Bristol Motor Speedway. You know, it takes a lot to run this half mile at Bristol, a very demanding racetrack. Elliott Sadler's team currently in fifth, and the subject of today's Built for Tough moment is exactly how you prepare a car for the Bristol Motor Speedway. What you do is you just reinforce everything, and you lift everything up in the race car. The frame rails are higher, the engines are higher, there's more front braces on the front, there's more braces on the rear of the car, so you can withstand all those bumps you can expect during a race. You have also Goodyear brings a different tire here. You have to be prepared for that, and you have to select the right shocks to withstand this demanding racetrack. Check out the website there. And Elliott Sadler currently having a fairly nice run in fifth position, Alan.
Okay, Marty, his teammate for Robert Yates Racing, Dale Jarrett, continues to go on and off pit road under this caution. We'll get a further update on that in a moment, but they're still cleaning up under the yellow flag in the Sharpie 500 at Bristol. 101 laps to go when we go back racing in the Sharpie 500 at Bristol for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series. Jeff Burton, Ryan Newman, top two, did not pit under the caution flag. And back on the lead lap, Kurt Busch, trying for four straight, was in front of the leader when the yellow waved. And behind him, Jeff Gordon, the lucky dog on that last caution. Dale Jarrett is in 10th place on the lead lap, made several pit stops under the yellow. We'll get an update there in a minute. Why is Jeff Gordon being black flagged? He did not go to the end of the line on the restart where he belonged, okay? So as soon as he got it back, Jeff Gordon's going to lose it.
He's going to lose more than that.
Right down the net one for the championship leader. Bill?
Well, Robbie Loomis is really upset. He talked to the, came down off the pit box, talked to the officials, made sure they were where they were supposed to be, told Jeff Gordon where to go. Jeff said, I was there, they waved me by. If they wave you by, they said you could go in front of him. Loomis continuing his discussion with the officials on pit road right now. Very unhappy.
Now he's being posted now.
And NASCAR race control being adamant that the 24 pit now or his next lap will not be scored.
They need to talk to Kyle. He's the one who waved me by.
Turn four drive through. I guess he will only lose one lap.
We'll see. So Jeff Gordon off the pace, your championship leader, with a little dispute with the referees. Here comes Jeff, 30 miles an hour down pit road.
What do you want me to do? That's through, it's a drive-through.
Boy, that is a long, long stretch.
Leader just goes by.
35 miles per hour feels like you're going backwards.
So it'll be one lap plus the field that Jeff Gordon will be down after just getting back on the lead lap. Here's the race for second. You see Jeff Burton, the leader, is pulled away from these two. Ryan Newman and Dale Earnhardt Jr. Earnhardt Jr. with much fresher tires. Newman not pitting under this caution.
And Jr. with probably a better car tonight here at Bristol. Now he's by Newman and sets off after the 30 car, Jeff Burton.
So Jeff Gordon has only ended up 15th. The last car one lap down. Now this is Jimmy Johnson, 48, Elliott Sadler, 38 for fourth and fifth positions.
These guys are in some traffic.
And Mark Martin and Robbie Gordon are battling for position. That's for 12th.
And that's what you're doing everything you can to get by the guy in front of you. And then you look up in the mirror and you see there's somebody right behind you, right under you.
Mark Martin in the sixth, 13th place.
the third car, one lap down. He is racing for 12th with Robbie Gordon in the 31.
And Mark's going to let him go, get back in line. Now, if Jimmy Johnson can get underneath the 31 and Mark can stay with Jimmy Johnson, he could follow him through.
Looks like Mark is struggling just a little bit with his six car now to get around the racetrack. He went down to turn three, and it looked like he had the same problem that a lot of others had. He bottomed out in that corner, and the car moved up.
Just like Marty's report, you know, they're building these cars. Everything's up so they can get the car stopped. So they come down, and that's exactly right. What's the 38 saying, Marty?
Not very happy right now, Wally. He came on the radio under the last caution, said it's had the least amount of grip it's had all night long right now. I don't know what to do. I'm trying the best I can. Todd Parrott, his crew chief, came back on the radio, said, you're doing a great job. Hang in there. Let's get a top 10 out of the night.
Dale Jarrett is running in 10th place after several pit stops under that last caution, Dave.
I wanted to define several for you, Alan. Several was six stops during that last round of yellow flag, and they think they made the right changes to it. DJ hasn't said a thing on the radio, and he's up to good speed right now.
So Jarrett trying to hang in there after getting bumped and spun around over in turn number two. Up front, hadn't taken Junior long to run down Jeff Burton. And it's probably not going to take a long to go by. How about the 30 car, Matt?
Last pit on lap 369. They've been a tug on the left front fender as he loses that spot to Dale Earnhardt Jr. Tug on the left front fender, also a slight air pressure adjustment. It felt like this set of tires was the best he's had all night. He didn't run through any debris, so they wanted to stay out and see if he could get what he could get.
Matt, Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s led more laps than anyone tonight, trying to lap Rusty Wallace again. The car has been very fast on the last stop. No changes for Junior. He told the guys, very happy with the car. It's very good. I think we got a win coming tonight.
Not sure it looked that way.
I tell you what, this is what this team needs to get ready for that final 10 races in the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup. Get some confidence up. Get a good car under the belt, which they have tonight.
Oh, they do.
Yeah, because it's been a lousy couple of months for Dale Earnhardt Jr. He's finished out of the top 10 in five of the last six races since Chicago. Our little Debbie lap leaders on the night will show you that it's been Junior a lot. 214, next most laps led, Rusty Wallace.
And he's just had that car down on the bottom all night, Benny. That, I mean, you know, that's what you got to do to get around this place. But see, look at that. Hugs the bottom.
Junior, one of 10 different drivers that have led so far tonight.
This car looks a lot like the 8 car that Martin Truex drove here in the spring in the NASCAR Busch Series race. So I think with what Junior learned last night, what they had in the 8 car in the spring is one reason he's running so well tonight.
Been a rally back night for Ryan Newman. Billy's up to third.
Boy, it sure has. Remember when he sat on the wagon during the Discover car, capped down to green? You don't just got to keep the nose clean. You got to try and keep the whole car clean. And he's done a relatively good job of that. He got his lap back as the lucky dog. Hit it for four tires, fuel, and no changes. The car is good. Picked up a lot of spots where those other guys pitted on the last caution. We'll see what happens in the last 80 laps, 75 laps.
Ryan now 2.6 seconds behind leader Dale Earnhardt Jr. Newman coming into this race in 13th place in the Nextel Cup Championship standings, 44 points out of 10th place. So what does the race to the chase look like now with all of some of these goings on here lately?
Ryan Newman has moved back into the top 10. Kane out. He's 27 back. Mark Martin up to 12, but he's 30 points back.
Look at how tight that is.
Man, and McMurray and Jarrett at this point tied.
Here's my thought on the broader picture of that tonight. With all the things that have happened to all the different people, right now, the order of them hasn't changed that much, aside of Newman sliding in there by a spot. Yeah. Most of the guys, you know, we saw Bobby the Body get spun. We've had Harvick out of the car, Kyle Petty in.
But it's just tightened everything up, and which makes these next couple of weeks even more important.
Let's get an update on Kevin Harvick's car now being driven by Kyle Petty, Dave.
Actually, Alan, I wanted to update you on Kevin Harvick. He is not able to talk to us right now because he's too dehydrated. His seat actually dug into his left bicep, according to his team. That was the biggest problem. Then it went numb. Very hard to race a car that way, and that led to the dehydration. Kevin apologized for not coming out to talk to us. Dr. Jay Golden Holden, the RCR team physician, is attending to him, getting him full of fluids and trying to get him back to health now. He'll sit in his holler and watch the rest of this race.
And, you know, that's a tough job for Kyle. I mean, Kyle's getting in an unfamiliar race car. I'm sure it doesn't fit very well, and he's just trying to do the best he can for that race team.
And the 29 car now being shown six laps down in 25th. place. Don't forget Kevin Harvick. This is the third race he's driven here this weekend. He ran the Craftsman Truck Wednesday night and the NASCAR Busch Series race last night. So Dale Earnhardt Jr. is out in front with 70 laps to go. In theory, having made his last pit stop on the night, but we'll see if the yellow flag waves again. You never know what might happen. Coca-Cola Racing family of drivers performing fairly well tonight here in Thunder Valley.
The Sharpie 500 on TNT is brought to you by Sharpie, Write Out Loud, by Chevy, the winningest name in racing, an American Revolution, and by Aflac. Ask about it at work.
62 laps to go in the Sharpie 500. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is gone from second place right now.
Yes, he is. I mean,
fun when you have a car like that here.
3.2 seconds is the gap from first to second. It's all Junior right now here in Bristol. Marty?
Yeah, career start number 171, trying to win number 13. Looks like that might be a pretty good possibility to do that tonight. And you talk about Dale Earnhardt Jr., and people who might have counted this team out to win the championship, that might have been a premature mistake. They have several tests left for the last 10 races of the season, like many of the teams who will be in the chase for the championship do. They start next week in New Hampshire, then they go to Dover, then to Martinsville, then Charlotte, then Kansas, then Phoenix, then Homestead, all in the next 10 weeks, trying to get ready for the chase for the championship. The A team is determined they can win this championship. If they do win tonight, that will be a big boost confidence-wise into proving that they can.
Junior has been dominant here at Bristol this weekend, not just tonight. Here's a race for seventh place. That 97 car, Kurt Busch, hasn't been in the focus much tonight. Started pretty deep in the pack, way back in the 24th spot.
Eighth spot now.
Got lucky, well, actually didn't even need the lucky dog. He passed the leader on a restart and was out in front with the caution wave to get himself back on the lead lap and try to make it four straight, leading us to...
It's time.
Yep.
Cue the duck.
Our Aflac NASCAR Nextel Cup trivia question. Who was the first driver to win four straight NASCAR Nextel Cup races at Bristol Motor Speedway? And if you listen to me earlier this weekend, you get it wrong because I had it wrong.
Maybe Cale Yarborough?
It was Cale Yarborough. Very good, BP.
Hey!
How about that?
Good, BP.
Cale won four straight races here, sweeping both the 76 and 77 events, all driving for Junior Johnson while racing for three straight championships. Of course, Darrell Waltrip, another four straight winner here, part of his record seven straight Bristol victories. And now Kurt Busch going for his fourth straight win at Bristol.
He better hurry.
Yeah, he better hurry. He's running out of time, Wally. Cale and Darrell both driving for Junior Johnson when they won all those races here at Bristol. Here, battle for second spot. Newman goes to second.
Only one problem for him. He's 4.5 seconds behind Dale Jr., Matt.
Alan, the big picture for both Dale Jr. and Ryan Newman is the championship this year. The big picture for the 30 car, Jeff Burton, just put that car in victory lane before season's end. Their bigger picture is 2005. They're continuing to try to gain confidence, continuing to try to gel. The best finish this team has ever had was a second 2 years ago with Jeff Reed in New Hampshire, trying to knock down a top five. They are having a very stellar night.
Yes, they are.
I'll tell you now, he's got some pressure coming from behind by Jimmy Johnson in the 48 car. You know, Jimmy told me Friday, just before qualifying, he said, I just cannot qualify at this racetrack. I seem to race okay, but I qualify poorly. And boy, is he correct. He does race well. Because he had to start at the rear, and here he is trying to battle for the third spot. Jimmy is battling for the third spot.
Jimmy Johnson's team pitting at lap 21 under an early yellow, then not pitting at lap 57 when most of the front runners did. It got him near track position. Moved him up to fourth, as a matter of fact, at that time. And Johnson has held his spot near the front of the line the rest of the night. .6 seconds behind leader Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Well, I tell you, he's going in a hurry, and you better get out of his way, because if you don't, he's going to move you out of the way.
Did he do that?
Well, he came up behind Scott Riggs here off of turn four, and look at the closing speed he had. Got in the back. Riggs did a great job saving that car. But Junior's got to be careful. I mean, that could have been him.
He's so much faster than most of the other cars, he's having a problem trying to judge his speed relative to theirs.
He's got the best car out there. He's just got to be patient right now and pick his spots. He can't just sit back and cruise because he's got Ryan Newman behind you, but he's just got to be careful.
So Junior clearly in command. I use the word for purpose. Another way to follow the race during the action is to log on to NASCAR.com and check out Pit Command, real-time telemetry. Set up your favorite driver's view. Follow along, in this case, with Junior and Ryan Newman, comparing their lap times, their telemetries, and all the rest.
As you see the go around, you see that Junior is one full corner in front of Ryan Newman.
NASCAR.com for more. 44 laps to go here at Bristol now, 43. Our last break during green flag action. Will Dale Earnhardt Jr. go to victory lane for the fourth time in 2004? Time for our Wrangler 5-star finish, August 2002. The Sharpie 500 here at Bristol, less than three laps to go. The aforementioned bump and run. Jeff Gordon on Rusty Wallace for Gordon's first win in what had been a 31-race dry streak. For more on Wrangler 5-star finishes, go to NASCAR.com. Not going to be Gordon's night tonight. He is back in 14th place, the fourth car one lap down after a penalty earlier. It is all Dale Earnhardt Jr. right now. Let's take you through the field, certainly through the lead lap cars. There are 10 of them. Marty Snyder with an update on the leader, Earnhardt Jr.
Just an awesome performance from Dale Earnhardt Jr. tonight, obviously leading the most laps. He's had nothing on this run. The car is excellent. No change from the last top 20 for his third career short track win, Bill.
Marty, only one guy goes to victory lane at Bristol, but there are going to be several winners here tonight, including the 12 car of Ryan Newman. That car wasn't very good yesterday. Right now, it's second, just over 30 laps to go.
Last week, Jeff Burton debuted in this 30 car, scored the team's best finish this season, a 12. Tonight, he's working on their first top five finish since last summer with Steve Park in Michigan. He hasn't said anything on the radio, just motoring along. 32 laps left to go to get this car in the top five.
Marty? Matt, three laps ago, Jimmy Johnson came on the radio, said the car is getting tighter. But after 3 weeks of engine failures and being in a backup car this week, this is a solid run for the 48 team, having a very, very good night. Elliott Sadler, the 38 car you're looking at, sliding around, no grip, hanging on though. Todd Parrott, his crew chief, telling him you're doing a great job. Todd, Dave.
40 car of Sterling Martin. Remember, he started third tonight, ran in the top 10 all night long. And even after he got spun on lap 370, has done very well. Fitted for two tires on lap 391 with no changes. Marty, back to you.
Dave, Jamie McMurray told me before the night started, we just need a top 10 tonight. So far, they have that, running in the seventh position. The man 15th in points. Pretty happy with his car. What a rebound for Kurt Busch. Was 36 in this race at one point. Has gotten back on the lead lap. Loose when the car starts out. It gets tighter the longer he runs. He'll salvage a top 10 out of what could have been a much worse night, Dave.
Marty, Matt Kenseth stopped for four tires on lap 391 and made a wedge adjustment, but he just radioed in and said, my car's too tight. I just can't do anything with these guys. Behind him, Dale Jarrett, again stopping on lap 391, just went down a lap to leader Dale Earnhardt Jr., but they stayed on the lead lap after making all those repairs, and now Jr. fighting, actually Dale Jarrett, fighting in 10th place, Alan.
We knew what you were trying to say there, Dave. DJ trying to hang on to his top 10 finish at this point. Greg Biffle, the next guy he is racing for that spot.
It's pretty confusing because everybody, you know, so scattered on who's on the lead lap, who's not.
So the race to the chase, Jeff Gordon losing ground to Jimmy Johnson tonight if they finish as they are. Johnson running fourth and Jeff running 14th. Ryan Newman moving back into the top 10. And guys who earlier tonight looked like they had opportunities to crack that group, finding problems at various points through the night and really not getting any help. Still tight.
Very tight.
Dale Jarrett was running second when he got spun around.
Now, Junior's in a lot of traffic right here. This is where Ryan Newman can make up a lot of ground if he can't get through the traffic.
Don't forget, next weekend, it's the new Labor Day weekend event for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series in the California Speedway. Under the lights, 7 o'clock Eastern time on NBC, 1 week from tomorrow. The race to the chase down then to two events. Then it's back on TNT in Richmond, Virginia, 2 weeks from tonight, under the lights. Junior trying to put Jeff Gordon two laps down.
Boy, don't you know that makes him feel good, talking about Junior, because he is Jeff Gordon had set on the pole and looked like his car looked like he was the favorite to win this race, and Junior is now lapping the 24 car.
You know, it makes an awful lot of people wearing red shirts in this crowd feel good, because a lot of them were just jumping up and down. 21 laps to go. What a night for Dale Jr. Started back in 30th place, pitted early in the race. Back on lap 37, then stayed out on lap 58 when the other front runners pitted, got himself track position, and has held it for the rest of the night.
Tell you one thing, that's going to be one exhausted young man when this thing is over. I think every driver out there, all 40 of them or 30 of them, are going to be exhausted when this thing's over. That 200 lap run of green flag in the middle just got the most of them.
Jimmy Johnson just got by Jeff Burton for a spot.
Beat the third place. So good recovery, knock on wood, for the 48 driver after three straight weeks of problems that found him in the garage long before the checkered flag was scheduled to wave. And going to California next week, a track where Jimmy Johnson runs very well. Former winner there.
Yeah, you know these guys on the 30 team got to be pretty happy.
I would think.
They have struggled this year.
Jeff Burton finished 12th in four of the last five races and the last three straight. So he's going to be very happy to come up with a top five or top six finish tonight.
See, Biffle there in the 16 car last week's winner in Michigan. This last run, green flag, he has been pretty fast in the 16 car. He is a lap down. He's currently in the 11th position. I don't know that he'd catch Dale Jarrett. Don't think he has time, but
he's only got 15 laps to do it, BP. He's got some ground to make up. So up front, the question is, will Dale Jr. get hung in any traffic? If so, is it enough to help Ryan Newman? Answer is probably not, as Newman is about a straightaway behind him at this point.
These guys have been at it for about 50 to 75 laps right here. Robbie Gordon in 31, Mark in the 6, Sterling in the 40. You got McMurray right here in 42. It's all, these guys have been racing hard.
And Mark realizes, well, that's 3 points in that 31 car in front of him if he can just get by.
Mark is racing Robbie for 12th place. Sterling Marlin not racing with these guys for lead lap spots, but Marlin is racing the 42 and the 97 of McMurray and Kurt Busch right behind him. And then you've got Matt Kenseth, and then the leader, Dale Jr., closing quickly on all of them.
Mark just can't seem to get close enough to the 31 car to really do anything with him so far. Boy, 31 really got a shot off the corner there.
Big story of Mark Martin's night, lap 227 under a green flag pit stop. He came down both pit roads instead of just the one that you do under the green flag, and it dropped him way back in traffic. He never has made up the ground.
And just think what might have been.
Oh, he was easy top five car.
I think so.
Easy.
That'd be heartbroken. Leader Dale Jr. just passing Matt Kenseth, putting the ninth place driver a lap down. Marty.
An even more impressive night considering Allen on the first stop of the night, they made a wedge and air pressure adjustment. On the second stop, they undid what they did on the first stop. Since then, only two air pressure adjustments for the eight car. It's been awesome from the beginning.
much-needed night of recovery for this Budweiser Racing Team from Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. Dale Earnhardt Jr. last won on May 15th in Richmond, Virginia. Led the championship after 9 races this season. Was second after 5 more. Dropped to 3rd at the Pocono race.
Sorry, Alan, but I'm looking at stuff out the window.
Yeah, Matt Kenseth got bumped and
there's the retaliation bump.
Yeah.
Boy, he had a 17. Way out of shape coming off of turn 2.
He got away with it. So anyway, about
right,
Junior.
I'll let you know if anything happens out here.
One of those kind of things. Just thinking back to July 18th, the day that he was burned in that fire in the sports car race, the morning of the sports car race out in Sonoma, California. What a tough journey it's been for the young man. Remember watching him walk into the garage area in New Hampshire, limping badly, the neck bandaged, wondering probably in the back of his mind if he'd thrown his chance at a championship away or how badly he'd hurt it. Certainly they've had reason to question that over the last month and a half.
But that's one good thing about this new point system that NASCAR has put in place, the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup. He could loaf a couple of races at when he was hurt, and he still is in contention.
I'll tell you what, it's great. The next 2 weeks are going to be a lot of fun. There's a lot of pressure right now on top 15.
Coming around to 2 to go for Dale Earnhardt Jr. He will have led 294 laps tonight of the 500. His father won here 9 times. He's trying for his first.
And what he does not want to see is
your white flag this time,
a caution flag. Let me get that white flag, he said. Please let me get that white flag.
And here it is, final lap for Dale Earnhardt Jr. 160,000 here at Bristol on their feet. Heavily partisan crowd at a place where his father had so much success. He won the Daytona 500 earlier this year. He'll add another of NASCAR's majors to his resume tonight as Dale Earnhardt Jr. wins the Sharpie 500 at Bristol.
I'll tell you, this place is so, it is a special win for these guys. This is a tough place to win a race.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., the first ever driver to sweep a weekend here at Bristol. The Busch Series race and the Cup race in the same weekend. I know that sounds hard to believe, but that's the fact. He's trying to do his donuts and other guys are trying to get back to the garage area. There you go, now the track's yours, Junior.
That's why you make the bumper strong, right there.
Marty?
May have been the first time someone's ever done it here at Bristol, but the third time Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s ever done it in his career. That's a very interesting burnout, isn't it? Tony Urie Sr., that reminded me a lot of his dad. Did it remind you of him?
Yeah, he loves this place. This place in Richmond, he loves it. And, you know, this whole team loves this place. Where could you go race in front of this many people, you know, and they all... It's like the whole stands are red up there, so a lot of Budweiser stuff. But, you know, we've lost this race twice and threw it away a couple times ourselves, loose wheels and stuff like that. So we're just glad to bring her home tonight. That Budweiser Chevy's been awesome all night long, and we needed this because the last 2 months, man, we've been awful. And, you know, we've had a slump going, and we got it straightened out tonight.
For this race team, an awesome night for Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Still got tires to roll on, but he burned them off by now.
That looks like a Chevy winning moment to me. Chevrolet congratulating Dale Earnhardt Jr. and the number 8 Monte Carlo on today's big win. No car has dominated Cup racing like the defending manufacturer's champion, Chevrolet and American Revolution. Junior going to roll up onto the roof into victory lane. We'll talk with he and the other top finishers in the Sharpie 500. TNT returns to Thunder Valley.
The Sharpie 500 on TNT is brought to you by Sharpie, right out loud. By Nextel, coast-to-coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. And by Miller. Vote Miller for President of Beers. Good call.
And welcome to the Nextel Post-Race Show from Bristol Motor Speedway, where Dale Earnhardt Jr. has won the Sharpie 500. And has just rolled his car into victory lane. Bill?
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in victory lane at Bristol.
the same place his dad was 5 years ago tonight, the night where he said he just wanted to rattle Terry Labonte's cage. And that night, it was an Earnhardt in victory lane, and tonight, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is here after winning the night race at Bristol. And as is common with these guys, there's a big celebration. Did you bring enough towels for everybody? Because we're going to need them here, man.
I killed the motor, what do you think?
Yeah, you had a little fire going on there, too. Well, tell me about your night.
Oh, man, I'm wore out. That's a long green flag run. I think it wore everybody out. First off, I want to say hey to my grandmother, Martha. My Uncle Randy had some heart surgery. He's getting better. And happy birthday again to my sister. All my family members. Man, this is one of the biggest wins of my career.
Why is that?
It's Bristol, baby.
It was a long road getting back to victory lane if you go between your last win and this one, Dale. You've had some tough days.
Yeah, you're going to have that, you know. You can't be number one all the time. It's what makes them sweeter, man. It's what makes the win sweeter. If they's handed to you, you know, wouldn't enjoy them as much. So, man, this is huge for me. This is awesome for my team. We really needed that. Hey, Teresa, I know she's enjoying this. This is awesome.
You've been coming here for a long time. Special to get up here.
Yeah, I come to a lot of races here when my dad drove. And, he made this place magical to an Earnhardt fan and me being one of them. So, I might not have done it like he did it just now, but it was pretty damn close.
Well, he was in victory lane here 5 years ago tonight.
Yeah, we seem to keep on matching numbers somehow or another, but wherever he's at, he's laughing. He's got to be enjoying that butt kicking. That was a good race. I didn't think I had that good a car, really, but she was bad.
You going to celebrate? You going to celebrate?
Oh, man, we got Sunday off. We don't get that all the time. It's going to be awesome.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. in victory lane at Bristol. I think he's happy, Dave.
Ryan Newman started fourth today, fell as low as 25th, a lap down. Are you happy with second?
Yeah, I mean, that was an awesome run for our team. We got more happy guys on our team than have ever landed on the moon, I'm pretty sure. But just a great run for our all-tail Dodge. You know, we got caught there in that pit deal. Gordon slid through his pits, and I was kind of gauging my stall off of his and kind of blocked us in. And had to fight back, got the old lucky dog again, and, used a little strategy. And Matt did a great job with the car. You know, we weren't perfect at the end, but it was good enough for second, and that's top five is what we needed.
No top tens in the last four races. A big recovery tonight. Marty?
Solid night for Jimmy Johnson. And as they were unloading the backup car yesterday, would you believe me if I'd have told you to finish third in this race tonight?
I believed it in my heart, and I believe it every week. Even with the problems that we've had and the mistakes that I've made, I know in my heart this team's capable of winning. And I was a little upset. Somebody got into me on that restart there, and I lost a bunch of positions and had to fight my way back to third. So too bad that happened, you know. But Gladys Lowe's team is back in action. I've got to thank my guys for working so hard. I mean, I put them through the ringer this last month, and then I hear this weekend in this hot weather, they've been working their butts off to get this backup car ready. So thanks to all of Hendrick Motorsports and Lowe's and all their employee owners, we're back on track.
Back on track, as he says, from 43rd to 3rd for Jimmy Johnson. Matt?
Unofficially, Jeff Gordon still holds a 24-point lead. You just about saw everything tonight on this half mile.
That was the hardest fought 14th place finish I've ever had at Bristol. You know, we didn't have the best car, but I think we had a top five car. But I tell you what, I'm on my way over to, what is it, the big white truck now, because I think they really made a big mistake on the call there for Black Flag me, because they, I knew I was supposed to go tail end longest line. I waited for cars to go by me there. The inspector of the pit told Robbie to tell me that, you know, if they wave you by or they're wrecked, then you're okay. And so I'm waiting. I look up. There's nothing but wrecked cars behind me that won't pass me. And DJ went by me, and then I think he was tailing long side, so he let me go by him. And then Kyle Petty waved me by him. And I got in front of him. We took off, and NASCAR black flagged me. And that cost us a lot of positions. So I want to find out what the deal was with that. I can't change it now, but I'm pretty disappointed.
Well, he finishes 14 tonight. Go plead your case. Dave?
Jeff Burton, the best finish for the 30 car this season. Ties your best this year at Dover, Jeff. How pleased are you?
Good night for us. This is a really good race team. We need to keep building. We're still not where we need to be, but we need to keep building. A great start for us. Need to say thank you to my trainer. I feel great. I'm ready to run another 500 miles.
Very good. Alan,
All right, Dave, thanks. So we've heard from four of the top five finishers, plus Jeff Gordon, and we look at the results from tonight's Sharpie 500. Elliot Sadler finished fifth. Remember what he said at the start of the race, how stressed out he was about it?
He's one happy camper.
He's probably the happiest guy there, except Earnhardt Jr., naturally, who's thrilled to death.
Kurt Busch's try for four straight at Bristol comes up short. He wound up eighth. Jeff Gordon, 14th. Mark Martin.
Bobby Labonte, 16th. Guy that was in the top, still probably in the top 10 of points, but closed it up.
Casey Kane, 21st place.
And Kevin Harvick will salvage a 24th out of that. Kyle Petty in relief.
Rusty Wallace led 79 laps, involved in a crash, wound up finishing 26th. And some of the drivers who spent considerable time in the garage with troubles during the race.
And Joe Nemechek, probably the saddest of this bunch. Almost made it to that crash.
Here's what I want to say.
Here we go.
I'm telling you what, this is going to be unbelievably close.
Ryan Newman moves up three places back into the top 10, displacing Casey Kane, who falls out.
Look at that. Two guys are tied, 35-35, 45-45.
And two races to go. Wow. So it's next weekend, the California Speedway. Then 2 weeks from tonight, Richmond International Raceway, the three-quarter mile short track, the race to the chase, very dramatic. The meantime, this evening was all about Dale Earnhardt Jr., who led 295 of the 500 laps in a dominating performance to pick up his fourth win of this season. Next Saturday on NBC at 3 Eastern, the NASCAR Busch Series race from California presented by Best Western. Next Sunday on NBC, 7 Eastern, NASCAR Nextel Cup Series racing from California, coverage starting with Discover Card Countdown to Green. Under Siege 2 Dark Territories, next on TNT, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is your winner tonight. As Dale Earnhardt Jr. wins the Sharpie 500 at Bristol.